Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is the third evidence session of the Committee's post-legislative scrutiny on the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014. We will hear this morning from two panels. May I welcome our first panel, which is Craig Ferguson, Head of Finance Transactions at South Lanarkshire Council, Melanie McKenzie, Strategic Commercial Manager, Aberdeenshire and Aberdeen City Council, and Lynette Robertson, Head of Commercial and Procurement Services, City of Edinburgh Council. As always, if members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that's helpful. If you agree with another panel member, it's enough just to say you agree with them and we can move on to the next question. Could I maybe come to the panel first of all with a fairly straightforward opening question? This is a post-legislative scrutiny piece of work that we're undertaking, so we're interested in what have been the key changes for your authorities since 2014, and give us a brief outline of what challenges there are, and other members will pick up on more detail on that. So maybe just come to Craig first, and then Melanie and then Lynette.
Yes, no, thank you, Chair, and thank you for the invitation this morning. I see that the biggest change since the Reform Act has been in relation to the level of transparency now that we see across council procurement teams, and certainly the publication of the annual report, I think gives that real transparency. It gives a level of accountability as well in relation to how procurement functions are performing. And obviously within that particular report, there's some discretion for council to provide additional information in relation to local spend as well. And obviously, as time has progressed since the Reform Act was introduced, there's been a greater emphasis on that level of local spend, and that very much ties in, I think, with some of the kind of community wealth building objectives that many councils now are seeking to achieve.
Come to you, Alison.
Thank you, Convener. I would agree with what Craig has just said there around about the transparency. I think I would also add to that around about community benefits certainly playing a much larger part in terms of procurement. And since 2014, certainly that's been an area we've continued to build upon. So very much a key focus in terms of our procurement activity, mm-hmm. And also pulling into that the environmental considerations and also fair work.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you talk about the reports, if you just remind me, are the reports all the same? Do they follow the same format? So if an outside organisation is looking at the local authorities, they could compare. Is it possible to do that? And
I think certainly the format is laid out by Scottish Government, so we're advised of the key elements that we must include within our reports. I think there'd probably be a little bit of difference in terms of the format and the layout. And, but yeah, I think the key pieces of information would
be
the same in terms of the reports.
And then you've both so far mentioned community wealth building. So the first session we had a discussion of the pilots that have been running. I think there's one in Clackmannan and some other areas. There's been five pilots. Have you had any, I don't think you were involved in the pilots, have you had any feedback on the pilots? And they seem to be a way of trying to secure more local procurement.
Certainly not being involved in the pilots and not being privy to any feedback around the pilots. But at council level, we are actually doing work across both Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire around community wealth building. Looking at development of action plans and working very, very closely with our colleagues in economic development. And in one of the councils in particular, they've actually taken on a procurement development officer role, and that person is a key contact between ourselves, local businesses, and buyers within the organisation. Mm-hmm. So that's something that's been really helpful.
Okay, thank you. And Lynette, I'll come to you, just a reflection of the 2014 Act and what kind of the big changes that have been positive
and
any challenges.
I probably mirror what both panel members have already said in terms of the transparency. There's certainly a lot more information in the public domain about what each of our organisations are delivering, and also opportunities that are coming up for tender. So there's a lot more information available to suppliers, I think, than ever before. I think that's a positive thing. I think we engage with suppliers a lot more. Obviously, there's the national Meet the Buyer events and things like that, but we also hold local events and do what we can with local voluntary organisations, small businesses, and hooking up and trying to see what additional supported businesses there are in the community that we can work with, given the changes in the legislation around that as well. But there's some really positives there. The challenges for us, I suppose, have been the additional administration that comes with all of that extra transparency. We didn't have management information systems, etc., in place in order to capture the data and be able to report on it. Our reports, they do follow a path, as Melanie says, but we widen those because we capture what our own authority commitments and policies are as well. So we expand on that and extend into other areas.
And can you, I don't know if anyone in the panel can say if there's been an increase in local procurement. And I think when we had discussion about community wealth building, Fife has increased quite a bit their share of local procurement as part of a strategy. Is that something that either of you have seen within your own local authority an increase?
Sure. We've got our own community wealth building strategy. That's been in place now for over 2 years, and there's five kind of key pillars across that strategy, and one of the central pillars is around local spend, and very much, you know, using procurement to influence our ability to increase local spend levels. One of the things we focused on quite early on in our community wealth building journey was the arrangements around Quick Quote, and prior to bringing in the strategy, when using Quick Quote, two out of five quotes had to be from local companies. We increased that to trying to achieve a target of 4 out of 5. So very much a way of bringing more local companies into that mix to make sure that they could engage within Quick Quote. I would say that despite that change, there's still a lot of challenges in trying to secure that level of interest at times. No doubt we'll come on later in the session to around, you know, barriers and perceived barriers to public sector procurement. But certainly having that focus through a kind of standalone community wealth building strategy, I think, does give a real impetus to councils to focus on what can be done locally. Albeit I'd say there's probably some root causes there, underlying issues around the local structures of economies, etc., that I think to a degree can inhibit what can be done there. And also the general procurement frameworks obviously still require that governance approach to be there. So essentially we can't award a company just by virtue of the fact they are local.
Mm-hmm. And Melanie and Lynette, do you have kind of examples from your own local authority? Have you managed to increase the amount of local procurement?
Certainly within Aberdeen City and Aberdeen Shire Council, we've had a focus across certain areas in terms of establishing dynamic purchasing systems. We've had some real successes there, particularly for Aberdeenshire Council, around getting small local businesses onto, for example, a minor works DPS. For Aberdeen City, established a training DPS and a DPS around employability. So lots of small local companies on those arrangements, with the lead services then able to call off fairly simply. And that seems to be working quite well. So, and generally, whilst, you know, where we actually have larger contracts, also trying to build in subcontracting. So whilst we're maybe not contracting directly with the local suppliers, there are opportunities for them throughout the supply chain. I think one of the challenges for us round about that is we do that, but we have difficulty around capturing that information at the moment, because obviously how we calculate our local spend is based on where we pay the invoices to. So at the moment, we don't have a mechanism to capture how much subcontracting is done locally without actually going out to all our main contractors, taking that information in manually and doing some work around that, which we have done pieces of. But again, that comes down to resource and time and ability to manage that. Okay. But those are some examples of some of the work that we've done.
Okay. I think we'll have other members who'll come to ask more questions about local procurement. But I don't, just to finish, Lynette, have Edinburgh managed to increase, without going into detail what works have done, have you managed to increase the amount of local?
I think it's probably remained constant. I think it was quite good to begin with, I think, because we're in the city and the types of services that we're buying, there's quite a good capacity for a lot of the services that we buy. For example, professional services and things are based in the city. But we've done more to ensure that that continues and strengthens. Like Melanie, it doesn't show in the data because of where the invoice payment is going out to suppliers. But I think the having to justify why you wouldn't lot a large framework, for example, has certainly pushed the boundaries there, and we've gone to the stage of even looking at smaller sublots so that very small micro businesses can take part in some of the very large frameworks that we're involved with.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for your answers so far. To what extent is there an inconsistency in the way that the sustainable procurement duty is applied to contracts across public bodies? Do you think there is an inconsistency, and how could it be made?
And there is a range of tools available to councils in implementation of that duty. There's a prioritisation tool, there's a framework tool, and essentially it's for councils to progress their way through the use of those various kind of support mechanisms. So I dare say councils at different stages in their journey in fully adopting all the principles and all the benefits of that duty. Certainly within South Lanarkshire, we have moved to essentially pulling together a kind of overall weighting within contracts that encompasses fair work, community benefits, and also climate sustainability. So that essentially, we've now said that we want to target 30% of overall evaluation within the technical envelope towards sustainability overall. Essentially, that ensures that across the various tendering contracts we put out, there is that consistency of approach. In a sense, that 30% provides that kind of minimum. Obviously, accepting as well that there can be some variation. You know, if, for example, you're going out with a waste management contract, then arguably at its heart is sustainability. It is about minimising waste, about maximising recycling, etc. But you know, essentially within procurement, it's providing that kind of guidance and that kind of framework so that procuring departments can obviously then follow through in making sure that the contracts that are delivering are meeting the aims and objectives of the duty.
I think I would probably add to that around, I think, yes, absolutely, there's the framework there of how we should be applying that duty. But I think we very much target that around about the needs of the local authority and what their perhaps local outcome improvement plans look like, and how can we use some of the outcomes that we're seeing through procurement activity to support some of the outcomes in those improvement plans. So I think, yes, using the framework, but each local authority will have their own individual needs around where they might want to target outcomes.
Yeah, I think I would mirror that. I mean, it's the duties are consistently applied from what I can see within local authority. But you look at each individual requirement and what the council levers they want to apply as well. So for some sectors where there's a problem around maybe gender pay or some other lever, you might want to increase the weighting that you apply as part of the tender process. But I think generally the duties are applied across the board.
And do you feel it needs to be strengthened in any way to help you achieve your goals?
I think the written submission from Aberdeenshire Council, although this was about sustainable procurement duty, you did make a point around the low level of spend, the due regard obligation and low level of spend. So I don't know if you want to say a wee bit about that. It's 50,000 for goods and 2 million for works.
I think what we had said within our response is actually at the moment, the mandatory threshold is quite high at 4 million. So we would maybe see that there'd be scope to maybe reduce that. And we do give due regard to everything above 50. Mm-hmm. just to make sure that we are, and that's built into our standard tender documents and processes. But I think just having that maybe threshold in terms of the mandatory application being lower would be really helpful.
Could I, Megan Chapman, followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Glenn. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning and for your contribution so far. I suppose I want to extend this conversation just around how we can use procurement better to deliver the social and economic and other policy outcomes that we might wish to. We've already touched on mentioned fair work, mentioned gender pay, those kinds of things. Melanie, in your response to Claire's first question, you talked about the considerations that you would give to things like environmental and fair work issues. Can you just say a little bit more about that and how you balance the requirements, the regulatory and legislative requirements of procurement with those policy objectives?
So we would very much look at that on an individual contract by contract basis.
Okay.
So we do have obviously our kind of direction set out within our joint procurement strategy that's shared between the councils and also a community benefits and sustainability policy. So we have that sets out our general direction. But in terms of our process, we kind of look at each contract on an individual basis, and then we look at where we could deliver the most outcomes in terms of, you know, do we want to focus more on community benefits in this circumstances? If it's a works contract, are we actually building in the environmental considerations into the specification? So they're there, and actually we're then able to focus maybe the evaluation criteria more around the community benefits outcomes and fair work.
And so how would you make the decision about how you are weighting those different considerations, or how you are saying, well, right, in this works contract we really need these social or environmental outcomes, and therefore you said, you know, you might write it into the contract, but how else might you determine exactly what it is the sort of fluffy outcomes that you're looking for?
So I guess the project team would do that, working with, if I take an example in Aberdeenshire, mm-hmm. working with perhaps our area managers, so where the area, you know, wherever that project is based, looking at what that area actually really needs and trying to drive the outcomes through that. So the project team would have those discussions, and that would be agreed with some support with from our community benefits and sustainability manager. And we then, for the larger projects, we draft up what we call a community benefits plan for inclusion within the tender pack, and that kind of sets out an approach in terms of those outcomes.
And you'd be pulling in data on sort of demographic data, socioeconomic data into that sort of decision-making process at that local level?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. That's helpful. Lynette, you talked about you raised gender inequality issues. How is it that you see procurement being a vehicle for delivering for tackling social inequalities? And what are the barriers? What do we need to do better, I suppose?
I think in terms of driving these issues through procurement, actually, what you're doing is trying to engage with the contractors to understand that these are the things that are important to you, and they're important to retain a sustainable workforce. And if you're including that and highlighting those issues as part of the fair work practices that you expect from your employers, if they want to do business with you, then mm-hmm. they'll take it seriously, and you would hope they'll take it seriously, and that they'll be able to demonstrate that. I mean, the difficulty we have is data and collecting data. We have obviously publications at a national level for very large organisations, but when you're actually trying to target and support small to medium enterprises to bid for your work, then you need to consider the proportionality of what you're asking as well, and their capacity to be able to meet any obligations, to monitor, to manage, and to change their work practices. So you might refer them to where they can get support and where they can get guidance on how to improve that.
The issue around availability of and collection of data is something I think it'll be a thread through yeah. this inquiry. Would it be possible? Would it be helpful if there was a standardised approach to understanding to all of that data collection, so you didn't have to have that conversation individually with at each moment when you're having those initial discussions with potential contractors and suppliers. If there was something, say, this is the data we've got. This is how we want it recorded for this contract. Would that make things easier, or would that just be too cumbersome a machine?
I think there's different organisations that are set up to register employer information about the standards that they hold, the quality standards they hold, their staffing information, their prompt payment statistics, etc. So I think, again, it comes back to that proportionality issue. Yeah. I think some large organisations will easily meet any obligation that you ask of them. Okay. But the difficulty is, if you're trying to encourage new business to grow, mm-hmm. to build capacity, you don't want to put too many asks and barriers of them in the way that they will find it difficult to meet. So it depends on the maturity of the market that you're working with, and they're all different, and you have to take that into account.
Thank you, Lynette. Craig, if I can come to you, similar sort of question. Do you find within that focus and the sort of community wealth building framework that you were talking about and the pillars, do you find it challenging to track the social, environmental and sort of other outcomes of your procurement spend? And what are the other barriers of the barriers that prevent us actually getting the social outcomes or environmental outcomes that we might wish to, given the current procurement setup?
Yeah, I mean, certainly it's worth just acknowledging just the overhead that can come with that.
Okay.
There's no doubt that, maintaining, even obtaining that information and then monitoring that information is particularly resource intensive, particularly as you go down the supply chain. Using the power of procurement to bring about the kind of changes we're referencing is the way to go. There's no doubt about that. Procurement is a very powerful tool to do that. But I think that there's also just that point around, essentially balancing the kind of wider social benefits we can get from procurement, and also with the core deliverables from a contract, mm-hmm. Which may well be, for example, building a bridge, where the contract specification is critical to the roads department, but equally, perhaps more from a corporate perspective, a national perspective, there's much wider objectives there that should be getting delivered through procurement, particularly larger scale procurement exercises, where I think the asks around community benefits can become much more meaningful, much more tangible. I do think, in terms of your point on monitoring that, I think that is a challenging area in terms of getting the data from contractors and essentially monitoring that. We're looking to implement a kind of dedicated community benefits reporting system within South Lanarkshire. That will definitely help. But it's acknowledged within procurement and across our contract managers that too comes with an overhead. Mm-hmm. But it's about making sure that the community benefits that are essentially promised at the outset of a contract award are then followed through over the lifetime of that contract. So certainly recognising that is an area where we can make contained improvements in.
Thanks, Ray. And I suppose just on that monitoring system that you talk about, that obviously comes with not insignificant overhead. Are there economies of scale that we maybe could be looking at, if not across the whole of Scotland, at least regionally, to understand what kind of monitoring, what kind of data collection and evaluation is required, or does it have to be on a sort of a authority by authority basis, given local variation and specificities?
Yeah, I would suggest perhaps at a national level, that's where organisations like Scotland Excel could have a role, where they have that visibility right. over the awards on a kind of countrywide basis. Obviously, that depends upon councils using Scotland excels yep. on frameworks. They're the only provider of frameworks that councils tend typically access. I think it will be a bit of both in terms of taking what is potentially available nationally and also the information that the councils have. But just acknowledging that would then be a further layer, essentially, of that kind of information flow between contractors, local authorities. But ultimately, I think it's an important stage to see through to make sure we are pulling together information to assess, really, are these policies working? Have they got the intended consequences that they hope they do?
Okay, thanks. I think there might be a role for tech innovation in there somewhere, but I'm not quite sure what it is, but I'll leave it there for now. Thanks.
Thank you. Colin Smith to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks, Camilla. Can I just follow up that point, Craig, around monitoring Fair Work? I mean, it's fair to say, therefore, that you assess, I suppose, the Fair Work commitments from the main contractor, but you don't monitor anything beyond that when they subcontract. If you've awarded a contract, is that the case? And is that entirely a resource issue?
It certainly is a resource issue. I mean, in terms of like a typical tender for regulated procurement, then obviously Fair Work requirements is built into that. And essentially through the scoring mechanism, we very much incentivise bidders to deliver as much as they can around the principles of Fair Work. And some of that may be in relation to what a contractor is doing now in relation to Fair Work, whether it's family-friendly policies, you know, recognising the role of trade unions, for example. Or there may well be that over a period of time, a contractor has a plan in place to meet more of those principles around Fair Work. But certainly in relation to what we can do at the point of contract award, we make sure we have in place the prompt payment certificate that's signed off by the main contractor, and that has an impact then in terms of ensuring the subcontractors in that supply chain are paid within the 30 days. So as we maximising what we can do at that point of award, but certainly there is a recognition that any kind of continual monitoring of that in relation to compliance with Fair Work principles, it carries with it a significant overhead, particularly given the sheer number of contracts that the councils typically award.
Okay. I presume that's the case for other... There was nods there, I'm sure, for the official record that everybody agreed on that particular point. Just on another area, I suppose, of procurement is around the issue of fair trade. That we had evidence last week from the Scottish Fair Trade Forum, and Scotland's obviously a fair trade nation. South Lanarkshire and Aberdeenshire are fair trade zones. Aberdeen and Edinburgh City are fair trade cities. And as part of your procurement strategy, you've got to include, a statement of general policy on fairly and ethically traded goods and services. Scottish Fair Trade Forum did a report a couple of years ago based on FOIs to local authorities of your spend on fair trade products. Aberdeen City was about £2,644 for the financial year 21-22. Aberdeenshire was £7,260. Edinburgh, £3,756. South Lanarkshire, £28,000. 668. South Lanarkshire, top of the table there, but I suspect the level of spend in each of your authorities is higher than that on fair trade. So what is the reason as to why those figures, I suppose, are not higher than that? Do you want to come in, Melanie?
So certainly in terms of responding to FOIs of that nature, it's very difficult because what generally we would do to respond to such an FOI is look at the data within our finance system, which doesn't necessarily hold the level of detail to be able to identify items as fair trade. So we don't necessarily hold a register of those, you know, fairly traded goods that we may buy.
So how do you monitor you've got a general policy commitment to what you're doing around fairly traded goods. How do you monitor that then if you don't really sort of publish that information or hold that information in a sort of usable way?
It's very difficult, I guess, in terms of our strategy and direction and how we approach the specification of goods. That strategy is clear and that flows through, but we don't have the systems or indeed the capacity, I think, to really monitor and publish information on that. It can be quite challenging, particularly given all the other reporting requirements we have within procurement.
And there's no requirement, I suppose, to publish those figures on, specifically on fair trade.
Yeah, so we do focus on where we are required to publish the data.
I don't know if Lynette or Craig want to add anything to that at all.
I think I would just add that we do most certainly support fair trade within the city, but we do have the monitoring issues around identifying the spend items, but what we do is we promote fair trade fortnight, and we hold buyer events. So, you know, we've had sessions where we've brought fair trade companies into our offices at Waverley Court for other suppliers and wider council buyers, service users to come in, test, see the products in person, get to know about the history behind them and why the goods are the way they are. And that those type of events do boost the sales activity from those suppliers. We have seen that happen, and we continue to support the fair trade. We're on the board as well within the city. One of my staff is on that. So.
What would if there was specific guidance from the Scottish Government that said this is a definition of fair trade within procurement, and each year as part of your annual report you had to publish the level of fair trade spend based on that definition. Would that be something that you could do with a change in the way in which you monitor that? I mean, is that something you could actually do, do you think?
I think it would take a bit of change in how catalogues and things like that were set up, particularly when it comes to goods. We get a wholesale catalogue of goods from the framework that we buy through Scotland Excel, for example, the collaborative frameworks. Some of the goods, the description perhaps doesn't fully explain, or we can try to put some kind of indicator on it, but when the catalogue gets refreshed, you're back to square one and you're having to seek out the items and redo it. So it's quite difficult to drill into the information.
Okay. I suppose one final question is just around resources. Craig, you've already touched on this, the resource challenge you'd have going beyond primary contractors. Has there been a drive in your local authorities to use procurement at a time you're having to make millions of pounds of savings every year? Has there been a drive to use procurement as part of those savings? I mean, our local authorities are absolutely pushing procurement as a way to save money, and presumably that's a tension with things like buying fair trade. Would that be fair?
I think that's fair. And potentially extending that conflict to buying locally too, where at times buying locally can be more expensive. So I think there is a tension there. I think within procurement teams where there's obviously a drive to make sure that procurement can bring about efficiencies. At times that can point to use of frameworks over perhaps other procurement arrangements. But certainly within South Lanarkshire, we see procurement as being a key area where we have made savings over a prolonged period of time. And some of these savings can arise just from essentially renewing a contractual arrangement and getting the benefit from a new competitive process undertaken. Or it can be looking at your specification, looking at your volumes, looking at demand management arrangements that are in place too across the council, across certain category types. So, and I think that is an area that will continue to be in focus, certainly within South Lanarkshire, given the financial pressures that we have.
Procurement is very much seen as an enabler to support authorities to find savings effectively to try and save money on existing third party spend. So to do that we will look at the best competitive rates that we can get. And I think particularly when you're buying goods, there's probably more of an emphasis on your outcome being, like I said, mostly about the price rather than the quality of the goods. I mean, there will be a percentage weighted towards the goods, but ultimately budgets are tight, and you know, schools will tell us why we're buying from that. I could get that cheaper off Amazon or something, and it's trying to get a balance of sort of the best outcome for everyone.
That line's been used in my own local authority. You can get the paper clips in the shop round the corner. Why are you ordering it from there? But yeah, absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Just before I bring in Colin Beattie, the committee has an interest in the work being done to close the disability employment gap. And I think quite recently the Scottish Government have launched, I think somebody's referred to the dynamic purchasing system, but there's also guidance on a new system that puts a certain emphasis on supported businesses. When this is quite, I think September it was published, so I realise that it's quite recent, but is that, do any of the authorities, do you give consideration to supported businesses, or are you looking at ways to try and increase spend with supported businesses in any way?
Yeah, within South Lanarkshire, we've awarded one contract to supported business in the last 12 months. I would say kind of general feedback from that exercise was extremely positive in terms of engagement. A kind of general observation would be that the number of businesses, the number of kind of sectors are represented on that supported business framework is fairly limited. So certainly we would welcome any kind of further expansion of that to ensure we can maximise the opportunities that are there.
Anybody else?
Similarly, I think we'd actually made comment in the consultation response about the limitations around the supported business framework at the time. We have taken some steps to try and direct some quotes towards some other supported businesses we've become aware of through Meet the Buyer events, for example. So we are trying to stimulate relationships and you know, target some opportunities for supported businesses, just not necessarily through that supported business frameworks. But we continue to look at that as a route where it's appropriate.
And Lynette, have you got
anything to add? Yeah, I agree. I mean, they're quite niche businesses as well in the past, certainly. So I think there is room for development there. We do use supported businesses in Edinburgh, but the demand for use will depend on what we're buying on any given. You know, there's we use our nearest supported business on the framework is actually in Fife. It's not there wasn't any in Edinburgh. Obviously, there's St Jude's Laundry within Edinburgh, which we support. If we can't use them to full capacity, we do what we can to promote them through supplier newsletters and things to raise awareness to other supply chains. But it's
when you're choosing a supported, because Colin Smith asked about cost, so are they competitively priced, or does it involve the authority making a decision around costs?
I think there's a balance there as well. I mean, one of the supported businesses we use is a sort of reupholstery of furniture, for example. We're probably doing it on quite a small scale, and so we're able to directly award that contract through that reserved framework. But you know, there's been other instances where we've used maybe courier services, and then the business actually closed. You know, we had to make an alternative arrangement. So it doesn't always work in your favour, but and again the wider selection, actually, because ultimately to get the best outcome, what you want is several supported businesses who are in similar businesses who are competing together, there's always a willingness from the sector to be quite flexible in what you need and what you want as well. Mm. They're good businesses to work with.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard that it can be quite difficult to understand in relation to a product or service which might have a higher upfront cost, whether it might deliver medium or long-term value. Now, obviously, procurement to some extent is used to manage costs, and there's a bit of a conflict there between maybe paying more up front now in the belief that in a few years' time you're going to receive better value for that particular service or item. To what extent do you make decisions which capture this so that the life of the product or service is properly assessed in terms of value for money? And are there barriers to that? Maybe Lynette, I can ask you to.
I think maybe what you're talking about is whole life costing. When we're looking at, particularly if you're buying products, you want to consider the product, the lifespan of the product, whether it's going to require maintenance over the life, whether at the end of its life cycle it can be reconditioned or recycled, or you need to look at disposal costs. So where you're buying complex products then, or our basic products, cars, vans, etc., you need to look at the whole cost of the life of the product, not just the purchase price at the beginning, because I think we all know that you can purchase something that looks like a really good deal, but further down the line you have problems with faults or issues with the system, which the maintenance itself can be really costly at the end of the day. So quality of product is important as well. So you may pay a wee bit extra for the quality of the product if over the life of the product you're going to have less repairs, less maintenance, and you're not going to have that huge cost at the end.
So do you have a process in place to...
We would capture that within individual procurement strategies for the commodities that we're purchasing.
Are there any barriers to this?
It would depend if it's new technology, for example. We've been looking at some new technology where the disposal of that at end of life cycle is an unknown at the moment. So sometimes there are barriers that we just can't get the answer for. So we need to do more engagement with the market to try and understand what we can do.
Melanie.
Thank you. I think when the changes in the regulations come into force, obviously at that point we could no longer just look at price, which I think was welcomed by the majority of procurement teams, certainly. So building in that element of quality, price comparison across, all types of contracts, I think is really valuable. Certainly something that we do in terms of looking at products, particularly. It is about not just buying the cheapest, but actually looking at that balance around the whole life costing and what will last. And actually, ultimately, we may, if we were to specify something that's kind of a basic item, but actually we may buy 10 of them instead of, two of something that's specified correctly. So that's a key consideration in terms of our procurement processes as well. I think where that can fall down a little sometimes is in terms of some of the national frameworks where there's a drive to show that value for money. And I think sometimes the suppliers who are bidding for those arrangements sometimes feel like they need to put forward quite low-priced products to be able to get the businesses of local authority through those arrangements. And in reality, the local authorities then don't necessarily buy those core items. We'd then be using those arrangements but buying non-core items.
But this process would rely on some kind of knowledge base that would be applied to that product or service. Is that systemic? Is it relying on the people in the procurement area to have that knowledge? Do they keep files? How do they do it?
So certainly for our own councils, we work very closely with the service areas who are actually buying the products and have the technical expertise. So we work very closely with the lead service in terms of any procurement. And where you have any commodities, where you have cross council purchases, you'd then take in relevant people into that process from across the council.
Craig.
Yeah, thank you. And certainly from memory, there's one kind of practical example I can give around essentially this kind of whole life costing concept. In this relation to the purchase of wheelie bins, where essentially through working with the waste service, they could demonstrate actually by buying a version that was slightly more expensive, made with thicker, more durable plastics, that actually was a longer lasting product. I think in terms of barriers to that, I think it goes back to the earlier point around the need to drive efficiencies through procurement. And I think that is definitely a risk to applying the concept of whole life costing, whereas around this is the budget we have in year. It is about making sure we can, obviously keep spend within that budget and looking to then drive efficiencies in anticipation of budgets in the future, having a level of reduction applied. So I think it is the old adage of, it can be a false economy to buy a cheap thing now. I think ultimately there is that wider financial pressure coming to bear that may, as I say, put pressure on the whole life costing concept, which I think is absolutely sound, but I think it is one that will come under increasing pressure.
Okay. Just to cover something a bit different, we've been hearing about the experiences of framework contracts and lotting, and I wondered for yourselves, how much of a challenge is it to make these opportunities accessible to smaller, regionally focused firms, and but while at the same time sharing the risk and ensuring good value? Lynette, maybe I'll come back to you on that.
Yeah, I mean, we've had a few experiences recently of setting up some frameworks for some very small businesses, sole traders, both within the building sector and also within the education sector as well, locally. So what happens there is where you're breaking down the component parts to quite small areas so that those with a sort of lower turnover, lower capacity can take part in the competition, what you need to do is actually upskill those organisations to enable them to go through the bidding process, because I think it's noted throughout, with some of the evidence that's been submitted so far, is that it is quite complex and it's quite, difficult for organisations. There's language that we use that they're not familiar with. There's forms to be filled out that they've never filled out before. So we make use of things like the supplier development programme. We engage with them to run some training sessions for organisations that haven't gone through the process before. Our staff join up with the supplier development team and we do that. We've done a mix of, we've done YouTube videos and things like that to help people understand what the process is about and what evaluation process is and how the decisions will be made to support their businesses, what feedback, they'll get through the process. So it adds a lot of additional work for us to be able to do that, but we consider that to be worthwhile work if the aim and the objective is to support smaller businesses to gain contracts through the local authority.
We've heard a great deal about accessibility being an issue, particularly for smaller businesses who don't have the same resources to be able to fill in your forms and comply with all the requirements. Now, are you satisfied that what you're doing is sufficient to open up that process?
I think we're doing as much as we can within the resources that we have, would be probably the answer I would give to that. I think all of us could always do more with more resources. I think as well, Craig spoke earlier about the quick quote process, which is a much more streamlined process because it's designed to be for low value purchases, which can help, one-off purchases and small businesses at that level. I think the ability to, the threshold was mentioned earlier, 50,000 threshold for services and goods is actually quite small, particularly on a 3-4 year term of provision. You're only talking about just over £12,000 a year, which is really not that much and should attract very small businesses, but actually we're asking them to jump through quite a lot of barriers and hoops and to understand a process and their technical ability on something they've never bid for before, when we could be steering them towards a quick quote process and making it so much easier for them. So I think there is something about the threshold and the flexibility that would be available to us to support some of these smaller businesses. The larger businesses, they're used to it. They bid, for many contracts across all public sector. They've got teams that do it, or they employ teams to do it for them. I think there's some improved results from those organisations that do take up the offer of help. The help that's provided, there's new guidance that's been made available on the supplier journey as well. It's all really good information. I guess the crux is, if you're a small business or a one-man band, your time available to read all this guidance and to take up the availability of support will be limited as well, so I can understand why it's difficult for them to do so.
Melanie.
I totally agree with what Lynette has said there around about, I think also in our organisations we are doing as much as we can within the resources we have. Certainly, I mentioned the close working that we've been had with our economic development colleagues over the last period of time. So, you know, that one person in a dedicated role supporting businesses has been working with local businesses to help them navigate things like the single procurement document, which is something we get quite a lot of feedback on. It's quite a complex document and they find that quite difficult to complete. So that one person has supported around 100 businesses in the course of a year, whether that's through signposting them to specific training provided by the Supplier Development Programme, or just sitting with that person on a one-to-one basis and going through actually tender documents. So a range of support we've been able to provide through that particular role. But I think in terms of picking up on what Lynette said about the thresholds, I also think an increase to the threshold for goods and services would be incredibly valuable. You know, if we were able to direct more through quick quotes, we could do that locally. It is a streamlined process. It does make it much simpler. So I think that would be a key point, certainly for us.
Craig.
Yeah, thank you. I certainly concur with what colleagues have said in the panel here. I'd also emphasise as well just the important role the Supplier Development Programme have. Essentially, they're in a kind of key position where they can see and understand how councils operate. But at the same time, they've got those very kind of close links with business, and they are based within South Lanarkshire, and we essentially work with them on a very frequent basis to deliver, for example, talking tender sessions. We're inviting local companies to come in and essentially receive that kind of core training around how to actually prepare a bid, what to look out for, you know, how to register for PCS, how to use PCS, for example. So I think that their role is pivotal in this. Councils ourselves, though, we can still make sure we are using our own social media channels, for example, using our own websites to make sure that our contract registers are fully visible so businesses can see what is up and coming in the next 2 years. We referenced the annual procurement report. There's an appendix in there that essentially sets out that delivery plan over the following 2 years, essentially itemising individual contracts that we anticipate coming up for renewal. So a lot of information is out there. It does require businesses, I think, to go and seek to a degree as well. But you know, as a marketplace, we have to make sure we're doing as much as we can to make sure we are making these opportunities known. Within South Lanarkshire last year, we looked at the potential for more local procurement of food, and we sent out a questionnaire that we engaged with hundreds of companies, and only 22 came back expressing an interest in actually providing food to South Lanarkshire. And when you whittle it down, it actually became quite kind of niche products where we could see a match between what those company suppliers were prepared to offer to us and what we were looking to essentially procure as well. So I think that's a really kind of live example of how proactive we have been in getting out and engaging with individual sectors. I think when it comes to training, that's a much kind of wider approach we take. We're trying to bring in as many businesses as possible, but we do certainly recognise resourcing constraints some businesses have in fulfilling the requirements, and even just the front end and understanding how the process works. So I think that there's ongoing work for us to do to make sure we are breaking down these barriers, taking away some of these perceptions around how difficult it can be to procure in the public sector, but at the same time making sure you get safeguards in place around insurances, around financial standing, given it is public money we're using.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'll now take Brian Whittle to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'm very glad, Craig, that you raised public food procurement. This happens to be one of my really big interests. And I really wanted to go back to this idea of, you know, the higher upfront costs you know, balancing that out with long-term objectives. And if there was ever a product where that's very much evident, it would be, you know, procuring locally procured food, you know, mainly because when we talked earlier on about, transition to net zero, so that miles, you know, of travel, obviously there's a big issue there. Fair trade and ethical, you know, produce, we charge our farmers and food producers with the highest levels of standards. And yet, the last time I looked through the Excel contract, the amount of food procured from Scotland was, you know, substantially less than we potentially would imagine. So, I suppose really the question is practically, how easy is it to do that? It's all very well. I'm sure we all want to. I mean, you know, we want the high standards of food in our schools and our hospitals. But the practicalities of delivering on that, you know, one contract through Excel or many contracts locally. And the reality is, you know, when I looked at this the last time, there's a huge variety between one council to the next in terms of the amount of locally procured food. So I wonder, you know, how difficult it is to, you alluded to it yourself, but how difficult it is to practically deliver on what should be, you know, a high priority.
I think practically it is very challenging. And obviously this against a backdrop of having nationwide nutritional standards that have to be met. So perhaps that in itself points towards the use of single suppliers where they can guarantee those nutritional standards has been a perhaps less risky approach to procurement. I think inevitably with food procurement, as with most areas, there are economies there. But I think there's an important point to be made around the subcontracting opportunities throughout the supply chain. And certainly we make sure that we do highlight to local businesses opportunities, even through Scotland Excel also. I think it's probably an area of spend that isn't particularly well captured. But I think particularly in relation to food procurement, I think that there are definitely challenges there. The work we've done in South Lanarkshire the past 12 months certainly pointed to, on the face of it, quite limited interest in local providers contracting directly with us. But we do know, for example, there are a number of farms across Lanarkshire that supply directly to Muellers. So it may well be it's quite convenient as well for some local providers to be part of those kind of wider framework arrangements where they are in that subcontracting chain and don't have to actually procure directly with the local authority. I think as well, as soon as you broaden out your supply base for food, there's then that additional overhead from a facilities management perspective, making sure that, yes, nutritional standards can still be met. You know, typically, there'll be a standard menu provided across most of the school's estate, so buying in from more suppliers potentially makes that more challenging. And there's also the various kind of health accreditations the businesses need to have. And again, that becomes potentially more complex the more suppliers you have within that chain. This is a piece of work that we're not finished with. There were 22 suppliers indicated a willingness or an interest to engage further. And colleagues are taking that up as a kind of separate stream of work and also looking at learning from other councils where perhaps they're further ahead in their journey in terms of local food procurement. But I think really kind of the key takeaway from me in relation to what we've done so far in this is that the level of interest that came back was somewhat disappointing.
If I could just add to that, can I come to you, Emily? I mean, as I said, there's a big variation across councils. I mean, South Lanarkshire is one of the ones that I look at, but I've also got East Ayrshire, who are obviously the gold standard, and I understand they're under real pressure here to try and maintain that just through balancing the budget. But Craig mentioned there this idea of maintaining a high standard of food, and potentially that's easier through a sort of central contract. I would suggest that the highest quality food, you know, that's kicking around is produced by our own food producers, and it's how we get that onto the plate. So in terms of the risk, in terms of the ability to have multiple contracts and managing multiple contracts, and is that a real barrier to progressing on this?
So, yeah, thank you. Absolutely. I think resource and capacity is a real issue around this. Obviously, managing those contracts at the operational level is with generally our catering teams across councils. They do have limited resources in terms of being able to manage that and manage multiple contractors, and particularly given the level of information, you know, they're required to have around menus and allergens. And as with everybody, I think, you know, financial challenges, I think, has impacted the ability to maybe do things as we would like them. But I think picking up on something that Craig had said there, you know, we also do quite a lot around about looking at the subcontracting opportunities. So working with a main provider of food, but ensuring that actually through that route, we're able to utilise produce from farms in Aberdeenshire, for example. So we've had some success there. I think as well, one thing we've certainly found over recent years for our councils is actually some of our local food companies are not interested in servicing the council's business directly. It's a huge logistical challenge for them, given, well, certainly in Aberdeenshire, we've got in excess of 250 schools. You know, so the establishment, the logistics to actually service a contract of that size, I think would be a challenge. Now, of course, we could split that into areas, but how small would we have to go and what would the resource impact be? So I think that's why we've looked at focusing more towards using that subcontracting route, because that's kind of a win-win. They are receiving our business through the supply chain. We're able to support them at local level. But again, it's evidencing that, I think, can be a challenge from time to time. Because again, we're paying someone else at invoice address, so we're not actually capturing that really anywhere.
No, I mean, I do agree it's very difficult to get the evidence. I did it myself in 2016. It took me 6 months to gather all that together. And the reality is that, you know, as I said, through the Excel contract, I was quite surprised at how little food was procured locally. And I think, you know, what Craig said earlier, Lynette, was around, you know, that it's easier to contract from, I don't want to pick on these guys because they could be brilliant, but Muller, you know, because it's easier for the farmers to supply to Muller. But when we're talking about fair trade, you know, I'm very much interested in fair trade for our own food producers, and they might not necessarily, you know, get the fair price that we want for farmers. So there is this extended tension. So, from your perspective, how can we make sure that there's a system in place that tracks where likes of food come, I'm picking on food, but where food comes from, and how do you innovate? You know, how do you do that? If, you know, because obviously risk averse. How do you innovate within the budget that you have?
I mean, a bit like Melanie, our catering manager very much leads on all our food purchasing. We work with them to set up frameworks. We use the Scotland Excel framework because it's a national framework, but we also use a local framework. We have our own framework for fruit and veg and baked goods, etc. And getting back to your earlier point around carbon miles, etc. So a higher emphasis on food miles is something that we can use as a lever as well to ensure that the products are not travelling from huge distances. And we had a meeting with food industry quite recently in Edinburgh, just talking about this issue and how we can improve the local purchasing of food products. I was quite impressed by the statistics that our catering manager actually had, and if I knew we were speaking about food today, I would have brought some of them along, but there was quite a high volume of locally produced purchased foods. But I think what he was reiterating was that in terms of local supply, it's the sheer demand, you know, the volume of product across the schools and care homes within the city that make it really difficult for smaller producers to come along and independently supply. So having them work with larger contractors who support the logistics of the deliveries rather than having multiple deliveries coming into school at any one time is key.
Did you say there's been a
the size of the authority makes a difference then? Because Edinburgh is quite a large authority, or is it the smaller ones, it's easier for a smaller supplier to provide them, but there's more bureaucracy in terms of the burden on the authority for being able to procure smaller producers?
Yeah, I don't think it's so much the burden on smaller authorities to be able to procure small. Obviously, in terms of resources, it's easier for them to link into the national frameworks. But I think if they've got farmers etc. within their locality, again, who have the capacity to meet their demand, then I'm sure there's a way that they would be able to overcome some of the obstacles that are there.
I'll leave it and come back later if there's any more time.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, panel. I wanted to ask you specifically about your experience of using Public Contract Scotland website. It has been on the go since 2008, and while there has been improvements in recent years, just interested in your experience. We heard last week from some of the suppliers that the website, it was an improvement having the one portal in comparison to what went before, that it was more transparent and it opened up opportunities to more suppliers, but it had been a bit clunky, although it was now had improved. So what's your experience of it, of using it?
Certainly from a practitioner's perspective, our procurement team are obviously very au fait with it now. It's certainly a significant improvement what we had previously. I think there is probably a perception from bidders and prospective bidders that it's not that user-friendly, that some of the language could be simplified to some degree, acknowledging that it's not always possible in every case, and there is just at times, you know, an underlying point here that procurement can be a fairly complex world. However much effort we've been to trying to simplify that. But I think just given that time that has passed since it obviously introduced, I think there would be an opportunity there to look at how it could be made just a bit more user-friendly. I think it's important that we take on board the feedback from bidders, from prospective bidders around that. But I suspect as well there'll be only so far we can go to simplify it, if you use that term. But nonetheless, even just things like, you know, graphics, how tables are presented, how we use bidder guidance within the various forms, I think there would be an opportunity there to look to see what could be tweaked that could perhaps take away some of those barriers.
But as a buyer and actually using it to put contracts up for suppliers, how easy do you find it using it?
Yeah, our team are very well experienced with it now. I don't get any feedback that suggests we find it that difficult. The one area that springs to mind would be around how we actually include bidder guidance within the various forms. The presentation of that isn't always great, and I think while we can tweak certain areas, there isn't a great deal of flexibility within some of the fields within PCS. But I think that's got to be balanced, again, making sure there is still that standardised approach across the public sector. But I would say there's opportunity there to look at what improvements can be made.
OK. Melanie?
Yeah, I would certainly echo what Craig said. I mean, as a buyer, you know, we actually have devolved procurement, so people within services with authority to procure on behalf of the council. And, you know, the PCS system is really simple to use at the buyer side. I think that there are improvements that could be made around the supplier search functionality. I think is a key issue for us in terms of how that works. It's not always the easiest to try and find suppliers within a particular category. So that can be an issue. It's not that useful as that kind of tool. So we more go on local knowledge.
So that is one of the suggestions we had last week, to allow commissioners to search by type of organisation, and so that you could improve your social impact. So would that be something you'd all find useful?
Yeah, certainly. That's something we've had feedback on at a local level within the council, that would be useful, particularly when we're looking at issuing of quick quotes. So we may have some knowledge around suppliers that are in that area, but always useful to be able to have another look? Is there anybody new who's joined the PCS system since we last did this exercise? So, yeah, no, we would certainly find that very valuable.
OK. Lynette?
Yeah, likewise. I think, you know, the staff are pretty au fait with the system now. We know kind of how it works and what its quirks are. And I think the supplier search function is an issue. It has been an issue for a long time. And also, I think some of the suppliers don't realise that the registration, once I think it's 12 months, it will lapse and it'll expire unless they refresh it. So often, suppliers say, "But I'm on PCS, can't find your details there." So I think it's just trying to make sure people are aware of how it works and the fact that their details may not always be available. And ensuring that suppliers keep the details up to date as well is also a challenge.
So, you've said that it's fairly easy to use from the buyer side, and the customer satisfaction survey for suppliers found it was moderately to very easy to use for the majority, but not all. But there is an issue for the micro businesses, because they lack capacity. When Lynette, you spoke about meet the buyers events and supplier development programmes and all the rest of it, is there enough emphasis on looking at how you can support micro businesses to use the public procurement system, or do you not feel that's your role?
No, we jointly deliver sessions on how to use the system, what buttons to click, where they'll fill details in. I think the opportunities for support are there. We also offer a drop-in session for suppliers to contact us at any time if they're having any difficulty. The systems also have help desks and support for people that are struggling. So if they're, the clock's ticking and they know that they've got something to submit and they're still struggling with a file or something, there's someone they can contact and say, "What do I do about this? Can't get this to work." So I think there are support mechanisms there. Mm. I think it's just there's PCS and there's PCST. So there's actually two systems.
All right.
So there's one that's fully electronic, and one where they would download documents and then upload a response. That system's probably a bit more straightforward than going through the...
The two systems you've just talked about, are they used for different things, or is it different stages of the same process?
No, they both support similar processes, but the notices out to market are only done on PCS. That's the only system, because there's a reporting functionality running through that one as well. PCST was to enable a fully electronic system to be used. And we talked about SPD earlier, so that means that once you've filled out your SPD form on that system and registered on that system, it's there forevermore. So a supplier can go in and refresh it the next time they want to use it, rather than start from scratch again. So that's designed to make it a little bit easier, but I think if you're not technically minded, you may find that some organisations may struggle with that.
Okay. Craig, you spoke earlier about perceived barriers. Is the website one of the perceived barriers for small businesses?
For PCS?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think certainly we did a survey around maybe 18 months to 2 years ago, of several hundred local businesses that responded, and certainly training was one area that came up as a perceived barrier, together with capacity. So I think in terms of training, I think you could reasonably extend that to, businesses, smaller ones in particular, just having the confidence to participate in a public sector procurement. The training is there, the webinars are there. I think it's making sure we are continually advertising the availability of those routes for local businesses. I think some will see that as being almost like a permanent barrier. It's perhaps not how they do business on a day-to-day basis within the private sector, but ultimately I think it's making sure we can. Some of this for me is probably perceived barriers. I think what we learn is that once companies get that experience, get one or two under their belt, the conference naturally grows. But appreciating the flip side, to put in the effort, to put in a tender, then not to win the contract, yeah, where you could be one out of 10, one out of 20 mm-hmm. bidding, that brings with it a level of disappointment. They may in turn perhaps put that same company off from participating again. But I think it's just about that balance, making sure we are accessible, making sure that the appropriate safeguards in place, but at the same time, you know, not using overly complex language where it can be avoided.
So just on that point you raised about small businesses keep put off because they don't win a contract, because they might be one in 10 that's bidding for it. Do suppliers that fail to get the contract, do they get any kind of feedback so that it can be part of a learning process of how they improve their bid?
Yeah, I think that's a really important phase in our procurement process for regulated tenders, where if you weren't successful in an organisation, we would give you the breakdown of your scores across the technical side and also on commercial. Mm-hmm. And we'll also give the equivalent score for the winning bid. And then we give a commentary against each individual element. Mm-hmm. So it could be there's four or five elements in the technical section, and we're giving feedback on essentially why the winning bid, you know, essentially scored more than the one we're responding to. So I think that's a key change in recent years we've brought about. The general response is that companies find that level of detail helpful. Mm-hmm. We can also offer, you know, individual conversations should companies want that, in the sense that that's part of their learning and also ours too, in making sure we are given the appropriate level of detail on the feedback.
Okay, thanks very much.
Murdo Fraser, followed by Kim Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. All the questions I was going to ask, I think, have been covered by others. So,
in
interest of time, happy to move on.
Thank you, Kim Stewart.
Thank you, Convener, and apologies to you and the panel for being a bit late today. I want to concentrate on some of the things that others have said during the course of this inquiry around about bureaucracy. And a lot of folk have said that things work well until the lawyers and the accountants get involved in the tendering, the buying process. Apologies to any lawyers or accountants amongst you. And from my own council experience, which is a while back now, you know, I'd definitely seen that risk aversity, particularly in my early years before the formation of the Aberdeen City and Shire Joint Procurement Unit. Do you think that risk aversity is still there? Do you think that that bureaucracy is still there? Or has that lessened over the years? Craig, please.
As an accountant, I can say that there is still that need to make sure we were safeguarding public funds and what we do. One of the key areas of focus on would be around the appraisal of the financial standing of an organisation. And there's no doubt that, you know, for higher value tenders, I think that's got a very important role to play, in a sense providing some safeguard to the contracting authority that there has been that level of due diligence undertaken. And also extend that to say, even taking a scenario whereby a company may fail a financial appraisal, and this is done with the input of the accountants, we will then look to what mitigation can be put in place. So it could be, you know, if a company wants payment in advance, we may decline that, but payment in arrears essentially de-risks that from a cash flow perspective. But also, particularly for a longer term contract, it may well be we would turn to a parent company guarantee, for example, or a performance bond. So it's not to say that if a company were to fail a financial appraisal, that's the end of the journey there. So I think for me that's around the kind of checks and balances. There's parallels there with health and safety, I think, too. Again, could be viewed as perceived bureaucracy. For me, I think that these are important controls as part of that overall procurement governance process.
Thank you. Melanie, please.
I think it's important that we have the controls in place, but I also think we need to be risk aware as opposed to risk averse. I think in terms of the financial, for the councils that we have the Joint Procurement Service for, we tend to shy away from using turnover as a key financial criteria for everything, and we tend to apply more credit checks, etc. We do have some involvement from finance and legal colleagues, particularly around larger contracts, but we also, wherever possible, try to adopt a set of standard terms and conditions. So rather than maybe in days past where everything had a bespoke set, we've really tried to drive forward a bit of simplification in terms of cutting down the number of documents, trying to really clearly section things into quite small chunks so it's easier perhaps for bidders to try and complete them, and not be overwhelmed by opening up the one document that's maybe, you know, 80 pages, 100 pages, but tried really to make some relatively simple changes, but I think they've been quite effective in terms of our own procurement and just trying to make things as, you know, having that lens whenever we're trying to make changes to our documentation for suppliers. You know, what if I was a one person, a sole trader, looking at these and I didn't have much time?
Sure.
So looking at things through that lens as well.
Thank you. Lynette, please.
Yeah, I think I'd mirror what you guys have said. I mean, we work with our finance colleagues to look at the risk around the contract. It can help to have that conversation with them as well about the market that you're working with and what their capability is, so that when we're looking at, you know, there's not a standard one size fits all in terms of turnover and ratios, etc., that we're looking at, that actually for this sector, is that the norm, and what could we do instead? What might mitigate that risk, and look at that. And the same for insurances. You know, we have discussions with our insurance manager as well about setting the appropriate levels for some of the sort of low level, low value spend as well, and whether it's appropriate and proportionate. Because sometimes if you're doing, particularly if you're doing a large framework, it might be pretty high value, but when you break it down into the component parts, the actual, you know, low level lotted delivery may be quite small. So we, rather than setting a sort of overarching level for the whole framework, we can look at component parts and break it down a bit further for those as well.
Melanie obviously mentioned what sounds like continuous improvement and try to get this right. Would it be fair to say yes or no that all of your authorities are doing similar? Craig?
Yeah, absolutely. Within the confines, obviously, of the procurement regulations you've referenced as well, in terms of that kind of risk appetite, that's certainly a factor too. I think that there's a kind of general point to me around trying to simplify where we can, both process and also the language used. And you're back to the other point around, you know, bidder feedback, and that's an important aspect of trying to encourage future participation too, allowing bidders to refine their approach.
Yes or no, Lynette, please?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Continuous improvement.
Grant. I want to come back to a point around about some of the commentary that was made about national frameworks and value for money. I think that was from yourself, Craig. And I want to ask a general question around about Scotland XL. What are your feelings about Scotland XL? Good, bad or indifferent? Lynette, please.
I think there's good things there in terms of if we're all buying the same thing, it makes sense to pull it together as a collaboration. But we don't use all of the frameworks that are there because we find for some items or for some services, certainly, a focus on what our local needs is a priority, and it's easier to drive that if you have complete influence over the end-to-end process.
So do you feel that you have the choice to be able to do that, or do you feel sometimes pressurised to join national frameworks?
I think more recently, I think there's been more of a push for us to use the frameworks more.
Okay.
But ultimately, I will always take the view that I'll do what's right for our authority.
Thank you. Melanie, please.
So we have always been supportive of Scotland XL, I think, in terms of that collaborative approach to the things we're buying. You know, at sector level, we're all buying the same. I would say that perhaps there's not enough done perhaps to, at times, to really drive that collective to the specification, though I think sometimes the frameworks are established and local authorities are then buying different items from time to time. I think as well, certainly would agree that more recently there's been more pressure to use the frameworks, and we do consider that as an option in terms of any procurement strategy, but we've always seen it as it's an option, and we test that against maybe looking at the market locally, you know, and all those things I think are really important in terms of actually that delivery of best value for the council. The other thing around the national frameworks, I would say, you know, community wealth building agenda, local suppliers.
Sure.
If we're going to have national frameworks, well, how do we get our local suppliers onto those agreements, and how is that engagement going to take place?
So you still feel you've got that choice, ultimately, but feel pressured? Not putting words in your mouth. Yeah.
There's certainly been a degree of pressure recently.
Thank you very much. Craig, please.
I would say good. And certainly, why do it ourselves if there's an offering there already from Scotland Excel? We use the vast majority of Scotland Excel's frameworks. And just concurring with what colleagues have said, that there has been a more recent pressure to even update our own standing orders to acknowledge that we'll consider Scotland Excel frameworks prior to agreeing a route to market. That's something we decline to do. We do that anyway. This is already part of our custom and practice. We'll look at what Scotland Excel have available. And ultimately, if it doesn't suit our purposes, then we will look to other framework providers.
Thank you very much. Craig mentioned the two ominous words, standing orders, there. We could probably have a week-long session on council standing orders when it comes to procurement, but I think with that, I better stop, actually, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just one final question, and I suppose it does address some of the issues that Kevin Stewart's raised around bureaucracy and Gordon MacDonald raised around the website, is that when we heard from the Chamber of Commerce, they talked about AI as being a possible solution to make things much more streamlined, to match contracts, to make it more efficient. Is that conversations that the local authorities are having around how do we use AI to improve these kind of systems?
It's not a conversation at the moment, no. I'm sure it'd have its purpose, but certainly what we try and do is make sure that our register is freely available and it has got search functions on that. But going back to an earlier point I've made, you know, we're on a journey here in making sure we're continually improving our openness, our transparency, and making sure that companies have that free access to information. So that may well be a conversation to have in the future.
Yeah. Anybody else want to comment?
Again, no, we've not really at this point considered the use of AI. We are in one of the councils currently part of a co-pilot. So actually using that to try and drive maybe some improvements around documents, etc. But no, not in a all-over.
It's just interesting to know, has it been, you know, some have had debates in Parliament around, and it's to what extent is it starting to be developed within the public sector? And there are, you know, the early stages of some of the technology. But it's just interesting to see if there's an awareness of it could be part of the solution.
Not using it in Edinburgh.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for your contribution this morning to the inquiry. That's been much appreciated. I'll briefly suspend the meeting while we change over witnesses. I now welcome our second panel of witnesses. I'm pleased to be joined by Gordon Beattie, Director of NHS National Procurement, NHS National Services Scotland, Stephen Connor, Senior Procurement Manager, Advanced Procurement for Universities and Colleges, and Rob Muster, Director of Capital Investment, and Joe Rowan, General Manager of Procurement, both with Scottish Water. Welcome to the committee this morning. I'll maybe just start with a general opening question. As you know, this is a short inquiry into the 2014 Procurement Act, and we're interested in kind of key changes you've seen in procurement that were achieved through the Act, and maybe start to outline some of the key challenges, but other members will pick up on those issues. But if I come maybe first of all to Gordon.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. So I've been in NHS procurement since 2001, and I was involved in some of the early discussions we had with the question over SMEs and SME involvement. So I've seen a big change over that time. I think it's been a positive move. The Act, I think, embodied a lot of the good practice that was going around at the time, and has given us a platform to build on. So that I guess, is, you know, kind of where I see the Act coming in. We've increased our visibility, I think, was a key element in terms of what is it we need to buy. We make it obvious, hopefully, to businesses in Scotland and throughout the rest of the UK and now beyond that, and allows people to plan to bid for our work. So I think that's opened up a lot. We brought in a new policies to be delivered through procurement, and we can do that because we have the ability to ask for these things in our specifications, and we can therefore focus on changes, delivering things like, you know, sustainability, community benefits, fair work practices. So a lot of good things that we can do with that. The NHS itself, my area is national procurement, so we do national contracts that are common requirements across all of our health services, so they tend to be larger value contracts. About 70% of our spend is in high-end medicines, medical equipment, and digital solutions. But within that, the primary and overriding requirement is for patient safety and delivering good patient outcomes. So in that respect, is fairly complicated. What we're asking for is fairly specific, and it requires to ensure ourselves and give us assurance that the products that we buy and the services that we contract for can meet those requirements.
And just so I understand how NHS procurement works, so you procure, you said 70% of kind of procurement, and then do the boards have individual procurement?
Yeah, so we work very collaboratively across the health boards with ourselves. I don't line manage the rest of the procurement services in Scotland. Our health boards have their own heads of procurement who report through their own area. So, but yeah, that's probably the rough balance is that. And our health boards take our national contracts and implement them. So they're our change agents within hospital areas, working closely with clinical teams and technical teams, states teams, to deliver the outcomes of the contracts.
Okay. Thank you. I'll come now to Stephen. So a similar question about the 2014 Act and what's been positive about it and where there might be areas for improvement.
So morning, everybody. Yeah, so in terms of the impact of the Reform Act, I think it's probably been sort of three main areas. So obviously there's been, with the lower threshold, there being a lot more spend is now kind of regulated, if you like, whereas previously the spend that wasn't regulated has now been regulated. There's been a big impact in terms of the kind of transparency and the reporting requirements, and obviously a major part of the Act has been around sustainability. So I think in terms of the impact of the Act coming in, obviously those have all kind of impacted the universities and college sector. I think Gordon just mentioned there about the sort of raising of visibility and profile of procurement, and I think that's probably been the biggest impact. I think one of the things as the Reform Act did was to legislate a lot of things that were already kind of best practice, and then the Reform Act kind of made those things, you know, legislative requirements. So in terms of having a procurement strategy, reporting on those kind of things. So I think that's been probably the biggest change, and I kind of think, kind of related to that, it's kind of done a lot to kind of raise the flaw in terms of the way that procurement is done across the sector. So I think a lot of organisations that were already doing good procurements would have continued to do it regardless of whether the Act had been put in, but the fact that the Act was then brought in kind of forced a lot of people to kind of address procurement in a way that they perhaps wouldn't have done previously. But also just add, I think, you know, the Act obviously didn't come in isolation. I think a kind of a key part of the Act being effective has been obviously it being part of the kind of wider public procurement reform programme, and obviously all the kind of transformation that's kind of gone along with that, kind of driven by Scottish Government, but also through the COEs. And I think that's been sort of a key driver in terms of the Act actually having an effect.
Okay, thank you. And I'll come to Rob and Joe. So Scottish Water, I understand, weren't a body who were identified in the Act, but you do follow the Act. That would suggest that you're quite keen on the Act. But do you want to talk a bit about what's been the positives of the 2014 Act? And
OK. Good morning, everyone. So I'll kick off. I think, as you've pointed out, Scottish Water, being a utility, is actually covered under Utilities Contract Scotland Regulations 2016. So that's the regulations that we are working to. But as a minimum, Scottish Water ensures that the general duties within the Act are incorporated into our procurement processes and outcomes on the basis there's no conflict with our duties across both those regulations. And again, I'll hand to Joe in a moment just to touch on some of the detail around that. Building on my colleagues on the right-hand side, though, Scottish Water takes our procurement and processes very seriously, being a utility and being one that is across the whole of Scotland, and the type of work that we do and procure ranges from significant construction, civil engineering, all the way through to digital and that type of activity, again, which is obviously covered by the Act, but again, we're doing that through the regulations. But things like transparency, consistency, and our ability to track what I would say significant contractors to smaller expertise within Scotland is part of the fabric that makes up our procurement within Scotland. And just noting that 70% of our supply chain are small and medium enterprises all the way across Scotland. So I don't know if you want to touch on any specifics around it.
Good morning, everyone. So in terms of the application of the Act, I mean, obviously, as Rob says, we're not a contracting authority within the Act, but we did at the time agree to take the general duties on board and put them in as better practice into our procurement processes. Okay. So we do that, and we do that for all the procurements. We've been more looking at how we can get best value out of that, how we can actually make these duties come alive in terms of outcomes, and that's been more of our focus over the last 8 or 9 years or so, as to really how do we get these outcomes. And I would say that generally the Act has been a very useful framework to enable us to go after these positive outcomes. In terms of challenges, we're not in the Act, if you like, so it'd be unfair of me to talk to the detail of it. We don't particularly find the duties challenging. We don't particularly find the reporting elements of it that we have to do in terms of it. We don't find that bureaucratic. We find these things as better practice. So we don't really have any negatives to say, other than is it time to sort of relook at the Act in terms of is there other things that need to be considered 10 years later? Is there things that need to be reinforced, or are there things that need to be added? So this is probably the right time to do it after 10 years to say, has the landscapes changed? Has the priorities changed? Is there other things that procurement and the public sector can do to get more value for communities?
Mm-hmm. And is that a process that Scottish Water are going through at the moment, or is there any areas you want to highlight with us where 10 years later there could be improvements, or there would be?
For us, I think particularly around the sustainable procurement, which you may come on to during the session, is an area where I think we need to step back and reconsider how the landscape sort of moved on from 2014. Scottish Water have a net zero target. We've got plans. It's almost the sustainable duty thing is sort of reuse it, but I think it could really help enable us. If it was refreshed a little bit, it could really help enable us push that net zero target further in terms of how we operate with our supply chain.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Murdo Fraser to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. One of the issues that this committee and our predecessor committees over a number of years have been really interested in is how we can use procurement to support local economies. And Gordon, you were touching on some of this in your previous answer. What I'm really interested in is what's being done to be proactive and engage with local businesses in particular in terms of the procurement opportunities that are there. Maybe I'll start with yourself, Gordon, as you mentioned this.
Yeah, I think a couple of things we do is clearly we advertise all of our tenders, so that allows people to see what we are going to be procuring. We have our annual procurement report, which set out our requirements in terms of the year ahead for contracting. And we also have some Meet the Buyer events. We've got a Procurement for Health event coming up in Edinburgh on the 25th of April. And we also attend other events like ProcureX, which is a big event in the autumn. We're also going along to the Supply Development Programme event in Glasgow in the summer. So we do that. We also have, use the procurement process in terms of PIN notices, etc., market awareness days, and engage with suppliers that way. Another element I think probably worth thinking about as well is when we award our contracts, we also work closely with our main suppliers typically and support them in what they do within their supply chain. For example, 100% of our fresh milk comes from Scottish farmers. We tender that on a lotting basis. It happened to be one company, a Scottish company, won that contract. But they work with all the local dairy farmers to deliver those that milk requirement across Scotland. Same with our fresh meat, so 100% of our red meat, pork, meat and lamb comes from Scottish farmers, again through three national contracts that are let, but they engage with the supply chain. And it's that kind of approach of continuous development and working with our main contractors, as well as opening up our contracts for lotting and allowing business to apply for the main contracts as well.
Okay, and just one follow-up to that. We often get feedback from businesses that they'll submit tenders, are unsuccessful, but they get no feedback on why they were unsuccessful. Do you have any mechanism to provide feedback to unsuccessful bidders?
Yeah, so everything over £50,000 covered by the Act, it requires us to do debriefing, which we do. Certainly our contracts are much larger than our average value contracts, about £4.6 million. We provide the formal debriefing process, so that's after the award and before the contract's entered into, to a 10-day standstill period. And that provides the bidders with a formal written evidence of why they were unsuccessful, where they ranked in terms of the other competitors. And it allows them 10 days to ask any queries over the scoring or how we've come about the answer. And indeed, it allows them to raise a challenge if they wish to challenge the award. That's the sort of formal mechanism they undertake.
Okay, thank you. Stephen?
just to follow on from that, I guess a lot of what I would say would be very similar to what Gordon's just said in terms of that the way that we obviously we're required to advertise things at the kind of lower level, which should hopefully encourage more small businesses and local businesses to bid. A lot of our universities and colleges, and we also at APUC attend Meet the Buyer events. So again, a chance to kind of get face to face with suppliers and be able to kind of advise them and also direct them to the various ways in which they can see contracting opportunities. But I think in terms of also the way that we lot at APUC, we do now frameworks and we kind of lot them, and we're always very conscious of lotting them in a way that we can do whatever we can to kind of to encourage, or certainly to not exclude smaller companies. So whether that's done on a kind of a regional basis or lotting them in along kind of category lines, and maybe try to break things down so we're not putting sort of huge behemoth kind of lots together that only the big organisations, the big companies can bid for. You know, we try and say we are very conscious of trying to make them more. And, you know, and that benefits us as well. You know, we're not just doing it for a favour to the local economies. You know, it means that we can get more innovative companies. You know, you can get better service through using these small companies. So it does benefit everybody. And also, I think also thinking in terms of that lotting, it's also thinking about what some of the most appropriate contracts are to kind of break down in that way. So again, Gordon there mentioned the food, and I think that's a really good one where that also kind of ties in a lot with the kind of sustainability side of things. You know, so you know, it presents a kind of real opportunity, something like food, as opposed to something where it's more kind of just a straightforward, you know, product that anybody can kind of provide. Something where with food, where there's an issue around kind of food miles and freshness, and you know, or whether it's organic or whatever it is, something like that. You know, there's a real opportunity there to kind of break it down into a way that appeals more to small organisations, and also that we get the benefit of, as I say, you know, whether it's produced locally, fewer food miles, fresher produce, all that kind of thing.
I'm sure my colleague Brian Whittle will have lots of questions around food shortly. But just ask you the same question I put to Gordon about feedback to unsuccessful bidders.
So, I mean, similarly, you know, obviously we're required through the Act to provide feedback if anything that's a regulated contract. But perhaps the other thing is just if someone is not getting feedback, just to kind of approach the contracting authority and ask them. I mean, in my experience, you know, most on the buying side of things, they are kind of approachable. If a supplier does ask for feedback, you know, more than likely they would give some level of feedback, even if it's not kind of required by the legislation. You know, I think they usually are quite open to that approach from suppliers.
Okay, thank you.
Rob? Thank you. Yep. So I think just recognising the focus on the business and communities, for example, we recognise Scottish Water as work everywhere across Scotland, so acutely aware of that. But when it comes to our actual procured supply chain, touching on my comment earlier, about 75% of our supply chain is in Scotland in terms of businesses located here, and about 90% of our spend is based in Scotland. And as I mentioned earlier, 70% of our supply chain is small to medium enterprises. But when it comes to allocation of work, we consider it very carefully between are we constructing a significant, you know, new treatment works, for example, or is it into the smaller infrastructure work, which is where it's the balance between the bigger delivery vehicles that we have, but also, for example, we have 65 regional partners and contractors that are part of our regional framework, which particularly across islands and some of the more rural communities, we're not relying on some of those bigger partnerships that we have. And that's part of our procurement strategy, is to make sure that we're allocating that work appropriately across Scotland. In terms of the transparency, how we do it, and that feedback question that you've had, I'll maybe pass to Joe, just in terms of our e-procurement and transparency.
Yeah, just a point to build on with Rob. I think it's, for us, the SME community is absolutely vital for us, but just given the fact that our scope of work takes us to the Highlands and the Islands and the Borders and all over the place. So it's not just Central Belt activity. So we have to build good relationships with those small businesses, and that's why we've got such a high proportion, as Rob said, of partners, supply partners in our water community. And how we do that is to actually redesign the procurement so that they're simpler, in essence, for SMEs to go through. Some of these SMEs, you know, they won't be able to follow a more complicated or stricter procurement process. Some of them struggle with actually the e-procurement systems that you've got to go through. So we've actually had to step aside from that and say, well, how can we actually make this easier for people to connect with us? And we'll actually send people out from our teams to those businesses to actually help them engage in the procurement process, because we want them to want to work for Scottish Water. We need them as part of our network and our community. So we've had to rethink how to engage with smaller businesses and encourage them to work with the sector. to pick up on the feedback question, yes, similar to my colleagues, we provide written feedback to all against all procurements, regardless of the threshold levels, and we also offer in-person feedback as an option to all bidders. And we find that that's quite attractive. People actually want to come in and talk to us and ask about how can I improve my tendering, where was my weakness, and we're happy to provide that feedback in person to them as well, because we want them to be successful. You know, we want people to come and work with us. We've got plenty of work.
Great. All right. Thank you.
Evelyn Tweed, be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. In 2023, research was carried out into Scottish procurement compared to other UK models, and it was found that generally it was a success, with the research suggesting that Scotland is regarded as a leader in the field of sustainable procurement. And it's refreshing to hear that Scottish Water has taken on a lot of these regulations, because you thought it was a good idea, you thought it would be best practice, because normally people try to stay away from this stuff if they can. But Jo, I'm interested in your comments. How can these regulations be strengthened 10 years on? How can they be made better to help organisations like Scottish Water achieve net zero targets, etc.?
So I've been, just a little bit of background, I've been in the public sector for over 20 years, and I think that I have seen a massive transition in the quality of public sector procurement capability over that time. And this is definitely the highest quality of professionalism I've ever seen, and that's coming from somebody who's a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Personal Supplies. And I think that's part of the strength that Scottish public sector has, is that we're developing high quality talent. I think that in terms of the sustainability side, I think there is more development required by contracting authorities on the how to get the outcomes that's needed and through their supply chain partners. So I think there's two parts to this. One is, how do we invest in capability inside public procurement, resources, people, to help them get the knowledge and the toolkits and the ability to be able to have the appropriate conversations with businesses on how to get more sustainable procurement outcomes. And I think that it's less about adding in more general duties into something more. So I wouldn't necessarily argue that we need more prescription. I think what we need is we need more description, i.e. what is important to the people of Scotland in this area, and then allow the contracting authorities the space to deliver the outcomes that the people of Scotland need. I think we're different now. I don't think we need to be prescribed what needs to be done. I think we need to be described and then allow the talent to deliver the outcomes on the thing. So that's what I would say. So more developments needed in the human capital, if you like, and we need to get more into the business community to help support them and how they can deliver more sustainable procurement outcomes for us. But that's going to take a good number of years. It's not an overnight thing. That's what we are finding in terms of reduction of carbon, for example. It's like, you've really got to go in and work with businesses. You can't just say, here's a tick box in the procurement process. You've got to actually go and visit them. You've got to understand their businesses. You've got to actually help them with it, in order to then reap the rewards of that 2 or 3 years down the line as they start to improve their carbon outcomes, as an example.
Anyone else want to come in? I would just echo what Joe's just said there. I strongly agree with that. I think there's in terms of kind of refreshing the Act or adding things into the Act, I don't know if that's entirely necessary. I think that a lot of it is more about, you know, I think there's already quite a lot within the, you know, the Reform Act and also the Public Contract Scotland regulations, which allows kind of a lot of discretion with, that you can do with regards to sustainability. And I think a lot of the kind of the and, you know, across the sector, public sector and my sector, we're doing a lot. But I think to kind of take the next step, it's more about, you know, it's kind of increasing that level of capability, and also I think the knowledge amongst suppliers, and also the kind of the, I guess, the knowledge and expertise internally as well. Sometimes, you know, again, just anecdotally, but sometimes you find that, you know, procurement staff are being getting a lot of kind of training around sustainability, so they're very keen to kind of move on stuff. But when it comes to kind of delivering a project or delivering a contract, they're maybe kind of bumping up against kind of internal barriers where they're kind of people kind of saying, well, you know, we're not ready for that, or we don't want to go there, or it's, you know, we don't have budget, or, you know. So, yeah, I think sometimes it's more, there'd be more about the sort of the wider, I say, kind of capability and resource piece than about kind of changing the legislation specifically, I would say.
I was probably going to say something similar, actually, in terms of maybe not so much in regulation, but I think set out some more shared targets and visions in terms of where to get to. Mm-hmm. We're certainly looking at kind of progressive improvements to get to net zero and what these would be. But a big element of that is the capacity that we have. You know, bringing in new solutions like digital solutions to release time to procure, so we can free up some time and allow people to have that space to really deliver on these initiatives. We have some great new tools around there in terms of sustainable prioritisation and tests like that. So we use those to focus our attention on where we can make the most impact on our contracts. And that kind of additional continued training, etc., that people have already mentioned, I think are really important. Not sure if that requires different regulations or new regulations.
Maggie Chapman, followed by Colin Smith.
Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us. I want to just explore the issue that Evelyn has raised. We know that there's a lot of effort put into thinking about procurement as delivering positive social, economic and environmental outcomes, as well as providing the goods and services that you all need to fulfil your functions. And I suppose I'm curious as to how you see those outcomes being determined and being set, and your role as procuring agents in those discussions. Do you have clear lines of conversation with other agencies or internally within your own organisations around how, you know, how you can actually use your procurement power to tackle gender inequality, for instance? How do you see the setting of outcomes or the aspiration of the procurement outcomes that aren't about service delivery or getting the stuff that you need? And I'll start with Gordon and work along, if I may.
Yeah, well, I guess it's quite interesting that procurement has become a way in which we can deliver better health. So healthy working lives, yeah. And that focus on healthy working lives, community benefits through delivery of that into our communities. These have all now become very much front and centre of what we're doing. And it'll be a contract-by-contract, subject-by-subject based in terms of what we do. Some of these things can be clearer in terms of bigger, larger construction contracts where we have community benefits more focused on employment. But we don't tend to have those types of contracts within my national procurement area. But what we have introduced is a community benefits portal. So it allows communities to effectively put on their wish lists of what they want support on, and allows us to link them up with our suppliers, who we've built into our contracts have an obligation to consider and deliver on community benefits. So at the moment we've got about 470 community organisations signed up to our portal, and we've got 530 suppliers. And this year we set a target of 34 community benefits to be delivered, and we've achieved 40 so far already. So those kind of ways in which we're doing that part of it and delivering something important for the communities. But in terms of the kind of healthy working lives, Fair Work First, that legislation, that we're following that. You know, last year in our annual report, 111 of our national suppliers were living wage organisations, and my own organisation, National Service Scotland, is an accredited living wage organisation as well. So that's the way that's the way we're doing it. Potentially, it could be useful to have some additional target set in terms of areas that's of specific interest through policy, and then we can react to that, because often procurement is seen to be a lever that you can pull. We can nudge the super tank around a wee bit, and we can respond to policy decisions.
So just that last point there around targets or identifications of the kinds of social or environmental impact that we would want to see. What would you see those coming necessarily from government, whether that's national or local, or would you see that as being community led, perhaps, or a mixture of
combination?
Of things?
I think a combination. Okay. Absolutely.
Okay, thanks, Gordon. Stephen.
So in terms of kind of determining the outcomes, so within APUC, we have a kind of a responsible procurement team. So at the start of a new framework or project, the person who's leading that would engage with the responsible procurement team, and then it'd be a case of kind of looking at, I guess, what are the kind of key sustainability risks. So obviously it's going to differ from contract to contract. Sometimes it's going to be more on the environmental side of things, or other times it's going to be more on a kind of on the social or fair work kind of side of things. And then it's just a case of, you know, so it's kind of using the expertise of that team to kind of try and thread things through, seeing what impact we can make through the contract that we're putting together, and try to do that kind of in an intelligent way, rather than just kind of throwing lots of things and seeing what sticks. It's try to kind of what's the kind of the most impact that we can make in terms of what we put into the ITT, what we put in, what kind of weighting we put in the evaluation, what kind of contract monitoring is going to be undertaken after that. We also engage with other organisations, so we have kind of close links with the EAUC, which is the Environmental Association for the Universities and Colleges, and also we are on the board, APUC, on the board for the Electronics Watch, which is a kind of human rights monitoring organisation for electronics industry. So we kind of take advice from them, and they kind of give us things that we could kind of start to put into our frameworks to try and kind of make the biggest impact. just kind of talking a bit more broadly, you sort of mentioned about the, you know, who kind of determines what's going to go in there, and I guess that seems to depend sometimes on who the end user is, because sometimes it seems to be, and again this is kind of anecdotally from within the sector, but sometimes some people are very keen to kind of be pushed very hard on sustainability stuff, and procurement kind of go along with that, and but other times the procurement are the ones that are kind of pushing and challenging more for that kind of thing. So sometimes if there's not much interest in something, then it's the procurement team that are kind of trying to suggest putting, they're making the suggestions in terms of what they can be put in there. So, on that point of view, it kind of just sometimes just depends. It depends category to category, and sometimes just it comes down to individuals' interests amongst the end users.
Thanks very much, Stephen. I suppose what you're alluding to there is sometimes students and staff campaigning in universities, campaigning for things actually works and makes a difference to procurement decisions.
Yeah, definitely. And that definitely brings a spotlight on things sometimes, and that has kind of that has directly impacted some of the decision making and kind of strategy inputs.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Rob or Joe.
Yeah. I'll kick off. Okay. Thank you. So first of all, just in terms of I'll start off maybe at a higher level in terms of the outcomes. Mm-hmm. Particularly in working together with other partners. So in terms of Scottish Water, one thing, for example, right now is climate change and climate change adaptation. And that's one of the big challenges for us as an organisation going forward, and I guess many others. And working together is going to be crucial for us to succeed to navigate that challenge, whether that's different partnerships we're seeking to involve, or ecosystems is one of the words that we're actually using in this arena at the minute. So part of the outcomes that we're looking at now is that ecosystem, rather than necessarily just a direct procurement. But it's also about enabling us to work with other partners like local authorities, etc., and some good examples of that that are starting to happen already. But if that's the high-level outcomes, for example, that we're looking at Scottish Water over the long term, that then manifests itself down into the work that we asked Joe to do as part of the procurement team within Scottish Water, aligned to our overall objectives. And one of those is, as I said, climate change adaptation, for example. But for example, when you get into process, you know, things like Fair Work First, it's embedded into all our procurements as I start for 10, you know, across the board, I think, as you mentioned. Also, and for example, we expect all our suppliers and supply chain to pay the real living wage, for example. So there's things from a process point of view that we're actually building into the procurement for by the challenge of that nature of what we're asking partnerships to do around us change as we go forward. From a process point of view, Joe, maybe I should just pick up on things like equal pay, gender pay, etc.
Yeah, I think one of the key things for us is that my objectives, my direction in terms of the procurement strategy and the supply chain design is based on Scottish Water's clear objectives and ambitions. Mm-hmm. So it's I've got less sort of like uncertainty about what we're trying to do with the sort of £1 billion or so per annum spend that we have. So I'm very clear on what value we're trying to get out of that. And Rob touched on something. We're very much about procuring outcomes. So we look at what outcome we're trying to deliver and then we work backwards and we build the process to get the outcome. So it's not really, you know, use a procurement process to figure out what the outcome is going to be. We actually try to understand the outcome and then work backwards on how we can get the process to deliver it. Mm-hmm. So that we've found that approach quite successful. In terms of, Rob's touched on things like Fair Work First, it's embedded in all of our agreements, as is the real living wage. And what we do is a lot of this activity isn't just in our frameworks or contracts. We actually go out and spend time in the business community to see how they're getting on with it. So we go out and through our business relationship processes, go out and actually meet businesses, talk to them, how are they getting on with Fair Work First, how are they getting on with real living wage, how are they getting on with gender equality. Mm-hmm. And what we found is that having tick boxes on a procurement for gender equality and things like that isn't that helpful. It doesn't really move the dial at all. You've actually got to go out to the businesses and talk to them about the importance of gender equality and about what their plans are and then, you know, where they are and what challenges they've got with it. Is there shared learning resources that we can provide them to help them? It's more post-procurement than in-procurement is what we've found to actually get the value out of it, to move the dial on the value. A fair amount of Fair Work First, real living wage and gender equality for us is all done after the fact when we're in these relationships and go out and actually make them come alive.
Okay. Thanks. That's helpful. And, I mean, you've all in your answers today talked about the need for sort of internal consistency and training and awareness raising so people actually understand why you are trying to procure for good. I suppose, and this is maybe a difficult question to answer briefly, but how often do you find that the positive outcomes we've been talking about, things like, you know, promotion of fair and ethical goods, of fair work, reducing inequalities, gender equality, all of these things, how often are those sacrificed because of cost? And how much of that could be allayed by the consistency and coherence of awareness raising and training and that kind of longer term social benefit, social environmental benefits that we see? I don't know who wants to pick that up first. Rob?
Okay. I mean, I think the key is none of our procurements are solely based on price. Mm-hmm. And certainly myself and colleagues working with Joe will look at things that have been mentioned already, like the social value, for example, safety, innovation, mm-hmm. etc. So we build that into all of our procurement. And price obviously has a weighting, as does the other aspects of procurement. And I guess those weightings and those elements are based on the types of procurement that we're doing, whether it is looking for an absolute surety of outcome by time, or whether it's something more in that partnership, learning, innovation space. And certainly that's the basket of, I guess, elements that we use in Scottish Water. So it's not solely based on price, but value for money is obviously very important, yeah, as part of the process that we adopt across the board.
I think what we've had to do as well is consider, can we do things like two-stage procurements where we can focus on the price and cost value for money and then focus on other values like carbon and other social values.
Yeah.
Because if you're doing one-stage procurement and you've got 100% of a value weighting, something like this, something like social value, could end up with 10%. Mm-hmm. So it's not going to make a huge, it's not necessarily going to make a huge weighting impact. So we've had to really consider how evaluations are done and can you do them in a different way to give these things much more space and importance. And can you actually just weave them in as principles and expectations? And as I said earlier on, actually then get the value out in the post-procurement arena. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're finding is there's more, especially when you're dealing with SMEs, you know, if you're dealing with SMEs like and you're trying to take them through social value stuff and all the rest of it, it's actually better to just, in our experience, to talk about it, to talk about the principles of it and get them to sign up to the principles of it. And then in a post-procurement environment, then get into the hard, that, you know, how are we going to actually deliver on that? Yeah. And we've found that much more, we can really move the dial, taking it out of the actual procurement exercise, if you like, and putting it in a different environment. So get the principles agreed and deal with the, deal, getting the dial moved in the post-procurement environment.
That cultural buy-in is important then? Yeah.
Yeah, okay. That's the critical bit, is getting them to buy into why it's important, but actually like putting weightings on it, we found that to be almost counterintuitive.
Okay, thanks. Gordon, and then Stephen, if you want to come in.
Yeah, no, I think we step into these things first to get good patient outcomes. So that's where we start. We then have lots of risk assessment tools to consider what the individual risks are within that contract. Mm-hmm. And we also have commodity advisory panels, which is subject matter experts that help the procurement people and the procurement teams establish what the award considerations should be in terms of technical quality, sustainability, environmental, etc. So that's the method we go through. So everyone's on a case by case basis, and it's relative to the subject matter. We don't do anything on price only, and I've got examples of the ones where they're 30% price or 70% price, whatever. But often there's mandatory requirements as well. You must achieve certain things, and that's something that we ethical procurement standards. We have mandatory requirements in some in our areas. So bidders don't get into the room unless they meet certain minimum requirements, which just gives us assurance of what we're going to ask for. People can respond in a good way and get good patient outcomes.
Thanks, Gordon. And Stephen?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, similarly, we don't ever make any decisions purely based on price. I think one of the key things is around kind of trying to kind of thread sustainability into it. You know, it's not just, rather than it being a separate kind of add-on piece, try to thread it through in terms of the strategy and obviously what goes into the specification, and threading it through also through the questions that it always kind of underpins the kind of the evaluation of it. I think one of the key things is as well is about trying to maximise the impact that you can make with regards to, and try to be quite targeted in what you do with regards to sustainability. So I think one of the best things you can do with regards to sustainability is, as I say, is to kind of really think about it up front and think about what it is that you're buying, and then, you know, as I say, depending on what it is, what are the kind of the key risks, what are the things you can really make a difference in, as opposed to, I think sometimes where things might get bogged down is where you're kind of throwing lots and lots of requirements at something where they might not be that relevant, and then, you know, sometimes if the tender document becomes kind of unwieldy, and that there's this, you know, and that's where you start to get the complaints about it being there's too much admin and that kind of thing. But I think if you can if you can do it intelligently, and as I say, you can then it starts to feed into the actual outcome as well. So you mentioned the sort of sacrificing certain things for the sake of value, but actually if you do it properly, then actually that it shouldn't be there shouldn't be a sacrifice, because actually you'd be able to kind of demonstrate the value. It's not, again, it wouldn't be an add-on, it becomes an integral part of what it is that you're actually buying. And so, you know, for instance, with something like Fair Work, you know, if there's a clear link between what it is that the if the outcome is linked to kind of, you know, better kind of employee happiness or satisfaction, that kind of thing, then actually you can clearly kind of demonstrate, well, actually, if we get this bit right, it might, you know, there might be an increased cost in terms of the wages that we pay or the kind of benefits that accrue to the employees, but actually we end up with clearly a much better contract, mm-hmm. Which is delivered to a higher standard or whatever. So I think that's the ideal way of doing it, I think, is being able to kind of really target the kind of most important sustainability aspects, and then, as I say, then it becomes a kind of a key part of what the outcome is, and it's all bound into one.
Okay, great, thanks.
Thank you very much. Colin Smith, we call about Colin Beattie.
Thanks, Convener. Can I just follow up on some of the points raised here? One of the issues that local authorities raised was about the challenges over monitoring and capturing data on subcontractors once a contract begins in that wider supply chain. And they made the point that the contract evaluation stage, their evaluation panels consider the Fair Work response that's submitted by the principal contractor, but they don't have the resources to then follow that through in terms of monitoring what actually happens when it comes to subcontractors. So I suppose starting with yourself, Rob and Joe, because you did talk a wee bit about discussions with supply chain. How do you monitor that those Fair Work principles are actually being delivered when you've got a big capital project? It could be going to a contractor and then subcontracted in a whole range of ways. How do you know those subcontractors are delivering those principles?
Okay, I mean, I'll ask Joe to step in a moment. I think he's already touched in terms of some of his statements so far about the visits and the attendance and all that and going out and actually testing, so I'll ask Joe to come in on that. I think in terms of the way that we structure ourselves post-procurement on some of the significant investments, we have strategic boards, we have all the evidence and things you would expect to come through that, whether it's relating to safety, health, well-being, financial performance, milestones delivered, etc. So I personally sit in some of those strategic boards with colleagues from both our subcontractors and main contractors. So that's part of the test and the governance that we put in around there, particularly in the key data capture. We also have a number of data capture activities, particularly from a health and safety perspective, that we drive consistency of information and evidence, which ultimately comes back to us to, I guess, give a balanced scorecard on performance or areas that we would want to go and look at. And it's interesting because we actually have what we call SMEs that work for us directly, and then we have SMEs that work indirectly for us through our main contractors as well. So it's about the consistency of approach that we're driving there. I think one of the things that helps us, and it doesn't diminish the need for a human approach to this, but it's some of the systems and the systemisation, the digitisation and the ease of capturing that information. And that's something that we're working very closely with our supply chain on. There's actually more to do to that in our future procurements around actually what I would call digitally integrating our system a lot better. And that's enabling the data capture right from source to come to somebody like me. Joe does, from a procurement perspective, the visits and the data capture. I'll ask Joe to touch on that.
So subcontracting. So we do have subcontracting, but what we do is that Scottish Water looks to create a supply chain design that has multi layers of procurement in it that we do. So we have very little where a primary contractor will actually go out and have its own supply chain. We will actually build that supply chain on behalf of the primary partners, and that's a little bit unique. And we can go down to three or four levels of depth in the supply chain, and that gives us what we call an ecosystem. So we've got primary partners actually drawing off of the wider supply chain that we have procured, which means that we can then embed Fair Work First, we can embed sustainability stuff, we can do that, and we can do that right across the different layers and complexities of the supply chain. And as Rob says, we're trying to then digitally enable that information a little bit more than we have. But all of this ecosystem that we see here is actually all available to all the partners. So if I've got a primary construction partner that's doing work for Rob, they can go into, it's actually the PCOS Scottish Government system we use. We've got literally 400 catalogues in there, 21,000 individual lines, and they can go in there and just draw off what they need from any element of the supply chain. That is critical for us because we can then get traceability and we can get transparency of what is going on there in terms of real living wage, in terms of Fair Work First, in terms of gender stuff. So that whole supply chain visibility gives... We don't see subcontracting as not a blocker for us. It is just a part of a wider ecosystem supply chain.
I would imagine, Stephen, building that for dozens of individual colleges and universities would be quite a challenge for yourself, but I'm keen just to hear how you would monitor, or how your college and university monitor that across the board. But I'm also intrigued by something you said around, the tension between best value and the other requirements from the Procurement Act, from your submission, in which you said potentially the requirement to consider wider policy issues is also leading to the stifling of best value and innovation. Contracting authorities can be focused on including all aspects of policy, fair work, environment, etc., that it becomes a box-ticking exercise and dissuades smaller companies from bidding. Mm-hmm. I'm quite keen for you to expand on the challenges there around that tension.
Just on that sort of that point. I mentioned earlier in a previous answer about, you know, trying to be quite targeted in the way that we think about sustainability with regards to any given particular requirements. But I think that the danger sometimes is that, you know, where if procurement becomes seen as being a kind of the vehicle for delivering, you know, every type of different policy, then it can kind of get, if it's not done properly, it can get a bit overloaded. So it can be, you know, for a fairly standard, you know, lowish value, you know, just into the kind of regulated space. But if it's, you know, what you could find, if there's lots and lots of additional things that are thrown on top of that, you know, in terms of what we're asking suppliers for, then there's a danger then that it becomes more about, you know, the part of the specification is quite small, and then, you know, there's a whole load of kind of raft of sustainability things kind of tacked onto the edge. And as I say, if it's not done, you know, if those things aren't relevant, then what you might end up finding is that, A, you know, small suppliers might be put off because we're asking them for, you know, for all sorts of different kind of policies and procedures and these kind of things that, again, an SME might not have. And again, if we're talking about a smaller value requirements, they might just think they might be kind of put off by that. What we might also find is that you get certain companies that might be very good at, you know, answering those kind of questions, but there may be a company that's better at delivering the requirements. But as I say, if a contracting authority kind of piled lots of irrelevant kind of things into it, into the ITT, then you might end up with a kind of imbalance where the company that wins is the one that gives all the kind of right answers on sustainability, but actually what is it that they're providing? So I guess that was the kind of the thinking behind that question. I think it's just a question of using, being more intelligent in how you approach it and not just kind of throwing everything at the wall and seeing what sticks.
And Gordon, obviously, feel free to comment on the issue of how you monitor beyond the sort of main contractor. But also, I mean, it's no secret the NHS is facing some huge financial challenges. My local health board just announced they've got a £35 million deficit this year alone. It must be the case that one of the ways in which you're seeking to find savings in the health services through procurement, that must be the absolute driver price at the end of the day when it comes to delivering. I mean, to what extent are you using procurement to try to make the significant savings that you're having to make, and what issues does that cause around some of these other issues around fair work and environment, etc.?
It's always been that way, Colin. My years in the NHS, we've always used procurement to try and get best value delivery, but it is, you know, absolutely the mix to make sure we're getting the right products and the right services. So I don't think there's any conflict there. One of the things that my national procurement team, we've got 1.5 billion in contracts, so a big element of that with the big inflation period we've had is to maintain those prices and to keep a lid on increasing prices. So we do work very closely with our health board teams about introducing change, different products, different suppliers, best value, etc. And that's just part of what we do. So you're right, it is a key element in terms of how we are going to help and support our health boards with the financial situation that we're currently facing.
Brief question for you all. Scotland's a fair trade nation, and public procurement's an important part of that. Scottish Fair Trade Forum a few years ago did a piece of work with the FOI'd public bodies to ask how much you spent on fair trade products. To say it was a mixed bag would be an understatement. I think Scottish Water didn't spend anything. Now, that may very well be. You just don't monitor that. You don't just capture that information. But certainly they said there was no expenditure from Scottish Water on fair trade product. College and universities, it varied from university to college. University of Edinburgh, for example, some innovative work around using fair trade graduation gowns and actually had a specific contract on that. Others said they didn't spend anything, which again probably comes back to how you monitor that. NHS again, it varied from board to board with some real big figures in some areas and very little in others. So is fair trade on your agenda at all when it comes to procuring products, and what do you do about it?
So I think we now have some fair trade products in Scottish Water, mainly through into our in the food side and our canteen environments and things like that. So we've made sure that fair trade is embodied in there. In terms of we were actually looking at fair trade in a slightly different way. We're keen to. So we've created a sort of wider ecosystem approach, and what we're actually keen to do is to offer the fair trade community an opportunity to be part of that ecosystem where they've got goods and services or products that could be used by the water sector. So not necessarily have to take them through a procurement exercise or anything like that, just to sort of like bolt them on into the ecosystem so that they can actually get the products and services used where it's appropriate. So that's really where our next stage is with it, is to really reach out there and say, and part of it is communication, so that we have to go out there and say, this is what the water sector is, why don't you come along and learn about it, we can learn about what you have, and can you then both do into that wider ecosystem.
Do you measure the value of that within your overall procurement?
Yeah, well, we would measure the value of that in our overall spend, because I don't think there would be any value doing it through a procurement exercise. Yeah. But I think that we could, once we get that established, that we're probably spending about, maybe about 20,000 at the moment in fair trade products a year. But I think that in terms of if we can actually look at this different approach, we could probably multiply that a fair bit if the products and services are there that we could utilise.
Stephen, is
that? Yeah, I mean, with regards to fair trade, I know that some of the universities and colleges, you know, if you walk into the building, they say they're kind of, they're fair trade organisation. I think probably with regards to fair trade, I think it's probably part of like a wider approach to kind of ethical supply chains more generally. I think, you know, if when looking at any particular requirements, then, you know, as I say, at that kind of starting point, when you're looking at what does that requirement look like, and you're identifying the risks around ethical supply, or where are these goods and services coming from, what are the risks that are on there, and then it's a case of, well, what if these are the risks, then what can we do to kind of address those risks? So fair trade maybe a part of that. I mean, there's been some kind of case law around the use of the fair trade trademark, and so obviously if you're going to specify something being fair trade, you have to kind of open the door for other things that may not have that same trademark but have a kind of equivalent, if you like. But I think, again, certainly in our sector, there's a lot of people would be on board with that. I mean, particularly with the a lot of the fair trade is around food and garments and that kind of thing. So I think typically for those kind of areas, that would be a focus, to say that, that we would ask for some things to have been fairly traded or ethically sourced, and then try and specify, lay out actually what that looks like, so people, so asking suppliers to kind of tell us about what their supply chains look like, how they manage it, how they manage their suppliers, telling us where the goods come from, and as I say, kind of what they do to kind of manage those risks. But I think another point in there that you mentioned is around the kind of monitoring. So I don't know what the level of monitoring of what fair trade products that the universities and colleges buy. So maybe I think some of them probably do. But I think just more generally, I think monitoring is kind of a huge area, particularly around sustainability stuff. We do a lot in the public sector around putting a lot in there around sustainability up front in ITTs, and I think that the next thing is to really start looking at what some of those outcomes are, and doing a lot to kind of making sure that things are actually being delivered through contracts. And obviously it's a good story to tell at the end to be able to show that these things are being delivered and the fact that that we are monitoring them.
And just on that, I suppose on that point, Gordon, that it's a mixed bag across the NHS. It probably does come down to monitoring as much as anything else. People don't always measure the full range of goods that they might buy as fair trade. Is that a challenge for the health service? Are you asked to even do that at the moment?
There's probably a bit of information I need to come back to you on. We certainly build in, as Stephen says, ethical procurement within our food contracts. So there'll be a range of requirements within our food contracts, which I can bring the information back to you if we wish. I don't have the information on the fair trade label. And as Stephen said, I know there was a requirement for us to set out what ethical trading is required rather than saying it must be a fair trade label, and the suppliers respond to that, and things that are teas, coffees, hot beverages type thing, and reinforce alliance, fair trade, etc. But I can get additional information.
That would be helpful. Yeah, be great. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to make some progress now. So if I ask members and witnesses to keep their answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. And if we draw us back to the 2014 Act, which is what we're scrutinising this morning, I'll take Colin Beattie to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Mention's already been made of procurement as a vehicle to manage costs or even reduce costs. We've heard that goods and services which perhaps cost more up front may over a period offer better value for money. To what extent are you able to make decisions which are informed by calculating that whole life value of the product or service that's being provided? And are there any barriers to that? And maybe, Gordon, I can ask you to come in first.
Yes, I think, again, it's a case-by-case basis. Where it's appropriate to consider whole life costing, we'll do that. And we'll build that in, we'll consider that over a sort of 10-year life period or the natural duration of the arrangement, and consider that as part of our overall award criteria. So that I guess, is how we build it in. In terms of barriers to doing that, I wouldn't raise any specific barriers other than it takes time for our experts in procurement to work with the commodity advisory panels to understand what those life cost implications would be, and to build them into a scoring mechanism that allows you to be clear in terms of the reasons why someone was successful, but equally clear in the reasons why someone was unsuccessful. And I think that's always the challenge, Colin, in terms of when people say to me, why can't you award to that company? The answer has to be, well, you have to be able to explain to all the other unsuccessful companies why they're not successful. So that brings you back to something that has to be quite clear, and that would be the challenge of making whole life costing consistent, clear, fair and equitable and transparent to everybody.
The whole of the public sector is under pressure cost-wise. Is it not true that perhaps this whole life costing and so on is less adhered to simply because of the short-term need to save money, to stay within budget, to reduce costs? Doesn't that put a lot of pressure on it?
I think what we're trying to get is as consistent, sustainable outcomes. And I said, you know, that support our patient care. That ultimately, you know, I guess it's if we get that wrong, then that increases cost of the service. So I think what we have established is a way in which we can consider all of the different parameters that build up to make a decision on which is the best product or service to buy, and that's what we follow. It would be we wouldn't be moving towards a point where it was price only. That would be that wouldn't get the outcomes that we need for our patients.
Stephen.
Yeah, so in terms of whole life costing, I mean, similarly to as Gordon just said, we do try and do that to the extent that we can. You know, obviously we try and build up kind of you know, cost models which kind of show, which would take in the sort of, you know, the running costs and the end of life disposal costs and that kind of thing, you know, so trying to build up a picture of actually what's the total cost of ownership of a particular product, for instance. So yes, I think that obviously we do try and do that as much as possible. I suppose in terms of the challenges, I guess one of them is the kind of the modelling of that kind of thing. You know, things can start to get quite complicated. So, you know, sometimes it's all right if you're doing a sort of product installation, maintenance, disposal type of thing, and you can kind of show that over a number of years. But if it starts to get overly complicated, then you kind of run the risk if you start to try and factor in, for instance, energy costs, that it might cost, how much it might cost to run, but then, you know, it's difficult to predict what the energy costs might be in X year's time. And then, again, as Gordon just said, in terms of explaining to a supplier that they may have lost out on a contract because of this model that you've built, that model obviously has to stand up to a decent amount of scrutiny. So, you know, it tends to kind of play it on the safe side of things. But I do think, I mean, to your point earlier, in terms of the kind of short-term thinking that... I mean, I think, you know, as a sector, we're reasonably good at sort of the medium and long term, but there are, I think, there's certainly a bit of the sort of year on your budget type of thinking, which sometimes stops things, you know, stops people, or if people don't necessarily have the budget in a given year to take the product that might, you know, that might last them several years, and they might take the decision to kind of renew something, you know, every year or every couple of years, where actually if they were able to, they might prefer to spend the money, you know, or to buy something that would last the longer. But as I say, sometimes kind of annual budgets can sometimes stop that kind of long-term investment, if you like.
And perhaps either Rob or Joe?
I think just a high-level response to this, as quick as possible, is that if I start off at the upper level, what Joe's touched on already, it's how transparent and clear can we be about the outcomes that we're seeking. And I guess being the type of organisation we are, we deal with some decisions that we have to make today for tomorrow, but we make decisions that we're making today for well past tomorrow in terms of that long-term activity as an infrastructure utility. And I think just to touch on Stephen's points, we have models that will model out that longer-term journey that we're on. And then if I can fit that and the visibility of those outcomes with the procurement that Joe runs, then that's where we get out of the cycle of short-term decisions affecting some of those longer-term outcomes that we're seeking. Clearly, again, value for money for our customers is important at that. And unlike the annualised side of this, from a water point of view, we're in the six-year regulatory period, and we're already starting to look at the implications for the next period and beyond as part of our strategic planning. So I think that the short answer is the more we can link transparency of outcome and visibility of likely work, we can balance that with our investment appraisal process, which will give us the right solution, which then hopefully allows us to procure both for the short, medium and long term to get that value for money.
Let me just go to a slightly different subject, which is we've heard a lot about framework contracts and lotting. Now, how much of a, what's your experience been? How much of a challenge is it to make these opportunities accessible to smaller and maybe regionally focused firms? You know, while sharing the risk and the ensuring the good value, it's quite tough. Gordon, I'm going to come to you, NHS.
So we do use lotting. I'd asked this question before we came. 46% of our national contracts have lots in them. Some of them are broken down to very small lots or specific to product types. Some are split into regional lots by health board region. So lots of our food contracts are in those kinds of areas. And that's to encourage and allow access to smaller packages of cost and more specific requirements. So that's how we establish it. I think sometimes it is still tricky to get a range of bidders for the individual lots. I think the example I was given was in terms of milk, we broke that down to lots for every health board region in Scotland, but awarded to one supplier because of the lack of competition. As a Scottish supplier, so that was good, there wasn't many small businesses. And one of the reasons on reflection, I think our team have said that, you know, as different organisations have different customer base, so other big milk providers might do doorstep delivery type services, other ones focus more on creamery cheese areas, you know, so there's a small number of suppliers in that particular example. So we do try and do it. And we do try to encourage as many suppliers as we can to come to it. Other ones, we will have a single lot, but that's is by the nature of the product, and it still is able for businesses to compete for it. We've just actually awarded a contract for imaging equipment, we have a new Scottish SME who's now come onto that contract, competing against some of the large multinationals. So it'll be interesting to see how we go on with those. And to help that general award of business, we've just had a show and tell a couple of weeks ago along at Ingolston, where the suppliers have come, and we've met with 70 of the senior sort of consultant medical technical staff from Scotland to see what the suppliers can offer and encourage competition.
I mean, one of the things we've been hearing from witnesses is how difficult it is to access, how complex the procurement process is. How do you tackle that?
Yeah,
I mean, this is particularly so for small companies that don't have the huge resources to be able to put together complex documents or the experience in it.
Yeah, I've seen the submissions we've had to this, and we have a supplier development programme as well, and we have our Scottish supplier group which we meet with, and we had a meeting with them just in the autumn there. We are going through a process through colleagues in Scottish Government to re-procure our procurement process, our procurement systems, so the e-procurement Scotland and our Public Contract Scotland tenders is going to be re-procured. So an opportunity there to work with our suppliers to ensure we get systems which are more user-friendly, if I can put it that way. So that's a piece of work that's going on just now, and hopefully that will help reduce some of the barriers to entry. I think digitisation and digital solutions is the way ahead to make that easier. But you know, in another respect, we are procuring complex products and services, and we need to make sure we get that right. So as they won't by their nature be straightforward and simple contracts or tenders, just by the nature.
Stephen.
Just to kind of briefly add to that, in terms of APC, we do obviously do use lotting in our frameworks as well. But I think just to kind of to add to what Gordon was saying, I think one of the key things is obviously around market engagement. So, it's around kind of understanding supply markets and being able to kind of structure lotting based on kind of market intelligence. And I think it's also, APC have been around for several years now. A lot of our frameworks are kind of going through their, maybe coming up to third and fourth iterations, and I think it's, it has been a sort of iterative process in terms of how we structured things the first time we did them, and then the second time, the learning from that, and then we're getting onto third and fourth, and hopefully we're getting better at doing more to kind of, I can think of frameworks that we've done where, the first time we tried to lot something, maybe the geographical lots were too broad, or the category, the way that we split it by category was incorrect, and then with a better kind of knowledge and understanding of the market, then you can kind of start to tease out more and better competition, you know, because of better structuring. But it has been a sort of a learning process. But I think market engagement is one of the key things.
And Scottish Order.
In terms of lotting, we do use lotting, but I don't really see it in the same way. We try to look at what outcomes that we're trying to deliver and then build the procurement around that. So we tend to use lotting sparingly. With 70% of our supply chain SME, we've got a lot of SMEs. So what we've really had to do is to desensitise the procurement process a little bit and acknowledge the fact that we have to spend more time helping these businesses to engage with us and be part of our community. So we've had to really pivot in terms of, like, you know, normal procurement versus SME procurement, and learn about that and change the procurement and change the questions and change the support network around them as well. So we will actually go out to the Highlands and the Islands. We will actually visit organisations, and we will actually sit in their kitchens if necessary and actually help them through the procurement process, which we've done in different communities. You know, so whatever's necessary to help these businesses become partners in the Scottish water supply chain, that's what we will do. So less about the use of lotting, more about rolling the sleeves up and helping the SMEs into get into working with Scottish Water is our approach.
Thank you.
Thank you. Brian Whittle to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Gavina. Still good morning. I was just checking there. I wanted to actually look at a practical example of this idea of upfront costs, higher upfront costs potentially delivering a better sort of long-term result. And I can't think of anything that's more relevant, Mr. Beattie, than the deliver of the food that we give to our patients. And, you know, the last time I looked at this, you know, in any great depth, there was a huge disparity in between NHS boards around potentially a hospital's ability to, you know, to prepare food on site, or where it seems to be going with development of facilities where food is prepared off site and brought in. Surely it must be really difficult to procure into the NHS. The size of the NHS, you know, locally prepared, locally produced food, and locally prepared food.
Okay, I'll try and answer that. Our part of that, piece is to secure good quality product through our national contracts, and we do that a number of ways. We obviously explain. We tender. We have contracts in place for fresh meat, fresh milk, etc. We also have main suppliers who have supply chains that we are able to nominate products onto. So a couple of examples I would say in terms of how do we get quality built into this is that we have, example, we wanted to create a source of sustainable haddock. We engage with a sustainable fish provider in Aberdeenshire. Our team were up there. They went on the trawlers. They agreed with the supplier what they wanted, and the fish has landed fresh into Aberdeen. It's processed in Whitehills, which is near Banff, and then provided through our main contractor into our Scottish supply chain. So that's an example of how we can work quite closely with local businesses and bring that food into our supply chain. That then is drawn in by our catering teams from across Scotland and put into the mix in terms of the way in which they provide catering to the hospitals. Another example would be in terms of the Good Food Nations Bill. We work closely in Fife. We have a requirement for a new baker coming in Fife, and we've been working closely with them in terms of that supplier development, helping them with tendering and supporting their input to tendering. And again, we link them into the main supply chain, the main contractor supply chain. So in that way, we can support new entrants in and requirements in. So that's generally what we do. And the ingredients are then drawn down by our catering managers who you know, are the kind of experts in terms of what they need to provide the food requirements to their hospital area.
Yeah, I think you know, again, I'm going to go back to this disparity. You know, the last time I looked at this in any depth, we had there are some fantastic examples, and you've highlighted some fantastic examples, but there's also some issues where, you know, food is being plated, prepared and plated outside of Scotland, as far away as Wales, and then driven up to our major hospitals. And one of the big concerns was around some of the wastage was around 55%. Now, that doesn't help us with the transition to net zero. This is not, you know, I'm not putting you on the spot here, but we have to, that's something, you know, we have to have a look at in terms of if you're unable to prepare food on site, we have to import it. And my concern would be we were importing some of that from where, you know, getting plated and prepared and plated in Wales and driven up the M6. So how do we tackle that?
I guess I don't know if I can specifically answer that question in terms of the food coming in from outside the area. I need to confirm if that's something that we actually do, or is that something that's procured locally through our health board. So I'll check that out first of all. But certainly what we require is to support our catering teams and ensuring they have the quality of food that's required for our patient needs. You know, I think it's so that's our focus. I can't really answer the question on
For clarity, you're procuring centrally for NHS, but local boards have the capability of procuring their own.
So we create national frameworks that people can use and draw down from. But if the catering strategy is different within a local health board, they may not use it in that way. So there is that choice. I guess I'm probably needing to take that back and come back to you with an answer around about more. It's more about a catering strategy, I guess, rather than as a bit of procurement strategy. So I can certainly ask colleagues who are more close to that strategy to come back and give more information on that.
It would be real helpful. I think obviously, you know, we want the highest quality food in front of our patients, and we want that locally. So if there's a way in which we in this place can change the way in which things are done, I would appreciate that. I'll leave it there if I can. Can you know we're against the clock?
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald will be followed by Commissioner.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. And it's still good morning, panel. So I wanted to ask you about Public Contracts Scotland website. It's been on the go since 2008, and when it was introduced, it was a really good improvement on where we were previously. But what's your experience as buyers now using that website, and is there anything that you could see that could be an improvement as we move forward? Gordon, you mentioned that it's currently under review. Can you see why it's currently under review, where the difficulties you're now trying to address?
Yeah, it's kind of an end of life in terms of its commercial tendering you know, contract. We have been extending it. We, i.e. colleagues in our Scottish Government Procurement Directorate who are responsible for it, have been extending it. And we're going to see that coming to an end over the next couple of years. And we are doing a national re-procurement of that, of those services that provide us with the e-procurement solutions, Public Contract Scotland. Public Contract Scotland tender, the tendering system as well as an analytics piece. Not my direct responsibility, but we'll work very closely. We'll be on subject matter expert panels, and we'll help ensure that we get a modern fit for purpose product.
Okay, Stephen, same question.
Yeah, I mean, similarly, I think obviously it's been a sort of a very useful tool that, as Gordon said, is kind of coming to the end of its life. As I say, I personally don't have much interaction with the tool, so I can't give a sort of too much of a view. But as I say, I think we're also engaged in terms of the kind of re-procurement and in terms of feeding in and gathering that kind of feedback from around the sector. So hopefully, whatever the next iteration looks like, will be a kind of improvement again.
Okay. And Joel, you think you don't use that platform? You've got your own e-sourcing portal. How does that compare with
or have you made any comparisons with the Public Contract Scotland website?
Yeah, we do use elements of it for the hosting of our catalogues. So if you can imagine a big Amazon site, so all our frameworks and contracts are on a big Amazon site inside the Scottish Government, and that allows all our partners and all our supply chain ecosystem to all use it.
Yeah.
So you get amazing compliance because it's all there, and they can just, everybody likes to use Amazon, so we've sort of built it in there. In terms of the procurement element of it, it's not suitable for utility procurement. It's very created around public regulations. So we found it initially, we were in it, and we found it incredibly restrictive, and had a few challenging conversations with our Scottish Government colleagues about how it was restricting us, our ability to do stuff. So we pulled out in a way and created our own e-procurement platform to give us the space and the air, if you like, to be able to do what we needed to do within our own regs.
Is there any functionality that your platform has that we should be building into Public Contract Scotland's?
That's a really interesting question. So our platform is really based on invitation to negotiate, and it's really quite sophisticated to be able us to do, and plus do a thing called innovative partnerships. So we're using quite different types of procurement approaches that a lot of our colleagues in the public sector are not utilising the same. So if I had one wish, it would be, can everybody use the negotiated procedure as a standard and drop open and restricted procedures and put them historically somewhere else? Because I think public sector in Scotland would generate much more value for money if it actually negotiated and trained its procurement teams to do effective negotiation around that. That would be my plea.
Kevin Stewart. Thank you very much. I'll thank the witnesses for attending this morning and contributing to our inquiry, and I'll now suspend the meeting and move into private session.